Hello and welcome to Glassdoor's Sleep Out or Sleep In 2020. We are live from Duke of York Square off King's Road in Chelsea in London, but we're kind of the only ones here because of that awful Rona, the restrictions. This year's Sleep Out is fully remote, but people are still sleeping out all over the country, in their gardens, on their balconies, on their front room floors, anywhere but not their bed, and that's the whole point. The aim of the night is still the same, to get the smallest sense of what it's like to be sleeping on the street, and most importantly, to raise awareness and money so less people have to sleep on the street. Since 2013, the Glassdoor Sleep Out has raised over £1.2 million, and it would be amazing if we could raise more this evening. And this live stream is going to bring us all together wherever we are in the country. And we have got such a brilliant lineup for you. We've got Glassdoor shelter guests who are going to tell us how Glassdoor has changed their lives, and Glassdoor really has changed their lives. A sleep specialist will be helping us get some much needed Z's. We'll be enjoying some morning yoga. With this back, that's not going to happen, but everyone else will be enjoying some morning yoga. The Royal Borough of Kensington and Chelsea Mayor Gerard Hargreaves will be joining us, as will former Chelsea footballer Paul Canoville. And to make sure we fall asleep peacefully and have the sweetest of dreams, actors Jim Carter and Colin Firth will be joining us. Jim will be reading a bedtime story and Colin will be reciting a poem. Do you love how I'm calling them Jim and Colin? The whole evening will be hosted by me, Bibi Lynch, and fabulous Elizabeth Healey. It's going to be a really great night, and thank you so much for joining us. What we're going to do now is show you kind of how tonight was going to be before the virus happened. This is how it's been in years gone by.
Sleep Out is the most important fundraising initiative in our whole calendar.
Glassdoor is about supporting these people with giving them life-changing meals and support at a time when they have very, very little.
Very worthwhile experience to see what others have to deal with on a nightly basis that we don't. We're very fortunate.
People often say to me is, you know, well, sometimes homeless people seem like they don't want to be helped. But I think actually being in the Sleep Out, you can understand how you can start to feel that you're not included in the rest of the world.
You know, when you watch those videos, it just makes you kind of want to get involved, and maybe you can't be here in Chelsea. We can hardly be here in Chelsea, but you can help get involved. You can donate if you're able. I know at times are incredibly hard at the moment, but seriously, every little helps. Who said that before me? Go to our website, glassdoor.org.uk/donate. So I'm really happy to introduce our first guest. We've got matching outfits on, that wasn't planned. We didn't get the email, the memo. This is wonderful Melissa Curtin, and Melissa is the Senior Comms Manager at Glassdoor, and she's the reason that kind of loads of us are here, because you emailed us and got us here. How are you?
Thank you very much, Phoebe, I'm great.
Enjoying
good
the weather?
British weather,
it's
what are you going to do?
What are you going to do? Quickly explain what Glassdoor is and what Sleep Out is.
Right. So Glassdoor is the largest network of open access shelters in the UK, and that means that basically anybody in need can come to us and find a warm welcome, yeah, some food and a place to sleep, and we also provide the support to help people move beyond homelessness.
And it's year-long support, isn't it?
It is, yes. Our shelters are only operated in winter time, but the, yeah, support is 12 months a year.
Yeah. And how do the shelters work? So you work in collaboration with churches?
Yes, that's right. So it's all about bringing the community together, and the churches have been a wonderful lifeblood and really spiritual home for the charity for many years now.
Yeah, but you don't have to be religious.
Absolutely, that's a really good point. So people of all faiths and none are welcome to use the services, as well as to, yeah, volunteer and to be a part of the community.
So what's the aim of Sleep Out?
So the Sleep Out started in 2013, and it was really just, we were looking to expand our services to reach the growing demand of people. There were more and more people coming to us looking for a shelter and looking for support, and we needed to raise more money. So it started off as a way to raise money, and it's become a great way to allow people to come together, to get involved, to come together as a community, and also it's done tremendous things for our ability to help more people. So we started off by just helping 35 people a night, and last year we were able to help 170 people every night because of this event. It really
has
helped us grow.
Amazing. So we've raised, I say we, 1.2 million since 2013.
And now it's probably just closing up to 1.3 million since 2013.
So where's that money gone? You don't do it penny by penny, but kind of generally, where's that gone?
Yes, it's gone into frontline services. So it's allowed us to bring more people in every night into our shelters.
And it's more important now. So what was that shocking FT report that it's like, was it a million people?
Half a million people are expected to be losing their jobs this autumn. And we know with eviction measures ending, we expect that there will be, some people are saying it a tsunami, a tidal wave of people.
Yeah.
And we're already seeing it. It's been really difficult because people, even though some of our partner drop-ins who we work with have not been able to operate in the normal way during COVID, some still have operated in minimal ways. And that's usually where people come to us, is through those drop-ins. But despite the fact that that's not running, we're still seeing an increase in the number of people coming to us for support. So we know the demand is already there, and we're expecting that to only grow as the weather gets colder.
So
and people.
How are you going to do it? Because with the restrictions as well, you can't run the shelters in the way that historically you've run the shelters.
That's absolutely right. So we have shifted, we've pivoted, we've have a whole team of people looking into different ways we can provide support. So we're going to be having single access, we're going to have single rooms basically, like a hostel accommodation to allow people to stay safe and still find shelter. It will be reduced numbers because it's a more expensive model, but we will do what we can to bring as many people inside.
Now, I know homelessness is kind of, the fact that it exists in 2020 just blows my mind anyway. I mean, it's just, it's unbelievable and, you know, going to get worse, and that's just horrific. And everyone thinks homelessness is awful. But you have a kind of personal motivation to be so involved. Do you mind saying what that is?
Well, it's interesting. I think when I first started, it was really just, in a way, a chance to give back. I feel very fortunate in my life, and I really just wanted to feel that I was able to give something back. And the longer I was involved, I started realizing there was other connections. I'm a daughter of refugees, and I've asked them, you know, about their journey and what happened, and you hear stories about the kindness of strangers, you know, how everybody relies on somebody to offer you a chance in the very beginning. And my mother arrived in Vienna without a winter coat. It was cold, and she was able to find a warm coat. And you know, you hear about these stories, and you think that's what we all need a hand up sometimes. And if we're able to, then we should. And so that was for me something that I connected with.
What's the message that you want to share with people tonight? So anyone looking in tonight, what, you know, apart from how to get these wonderful tops, how do they get these tops?
We're 20. You can go online, and our website does have a link. What's really important is that we all feel like we can do something. So whether you talk to your neighbor, whether you talk to somebody on the street, whether you write an email to your MP, whether you go online and find out more about homelessness, make a donation. It's about coming together and seeing what you can do.
And especially now.
And especially now.
What do I have to do to get a hat?
I know some people. I can help you out.
Thank you, Miss. Coronavirus has just kind of touched everything, is it, forever and ever, and it is really going to impact on homelessness. And so we'd love you to donate. Go to glassdoor.org.uk/donate, but we also want you to get involved in tonight and the spirit of tonight. And I did Sleep Out last year, I'm doing it tonight. It's a kind of weirdly bonding experience. It's actually a really lovely, empowering, cold thing to do, and it's kind of cool to do it. And if you are getting involved, we'd love to see how you're doing it, what your photos are, what's your sleep bag like, tweet us, send us pictures, send us your posts, tell us how you're getting on, if you're having any hot snacks, if you're wearing red. So get in touch. Facebook is Glassdoor Homeless Charity, or Twitter is Glassdoor London.
Inspiration. Dignity.
Safety.
Community.
Shelter.
Warmth.
Valued.
Passionate.
Opportunity.
Kindness.
Flexible.
Future.
Friendship.
Respect.
Change.
Glassdoor is special because our doors are open to everyone.
Glassdoor is special because we restore people's dignity.
Glassdoor is just special because they give me a support.
Glassdoor is special because we serve good food made with love.
Glassdoor is special because it's a safety net for those who have nowhere else to go.
Glassdoor is special because it provides a sense of community to the people that come.
Glassdoor is special because it gives people the inspiration to return to employment.
Glassdoor is special because it's opened doors and given me opportunities to move forward.
Glassdoor is special because everybody is treated with respect.
Glassdoor is special for me because they became my family.
Glassdoor have helped me and made me feel valued.
Glassdoor is special because of the kindness it shows everyone.
So Glassdoor is special because they're passionate about working with the homeless and with those struggling with poverty. It's not just a job for them.
Glassdoor is special because it's about loving our fellow human beings.
Glassdoor is special because we welcome everyone.
Glassdoor is special because I find warmth, security and safety.
Glassdoor is special because they care about people. They care about me.
So at Glassdoor, every person is special, and that's a video showing people, the guests that Glassdoor have helped. Let's take a look and see how much we've raised. So already, so far, this event has raised, wow, 105,000. That's absolutely brilliant. This sleep hack just captures people, it captures people. I wanted to say thank you to Melissa, thank you, Missa. And one of the people that I was so excited to meet today, so I'm going to say hello to James. Hello, James.
Hello.
How are you?
Not too bad.
So you've got one of the hats as well.
Amazed.
Right, I'm going to, that's it.
I've
never worked with someone.
Thank you very much.
So I wanted to meet you. So I watched your video today and I found it so moving and so powerful because it really, so the video is on the Glassdoor website, because it really showed how homelessness can affect anyone just by a quirk of fate, or as you called it, being ambushed. Tell us your story.
Well, at the end of the day, it was because I lost my job and finances were coming through, there was friction in the family, there's problems.
Yeah.
And everything sort of came over the top of every, you know, it's like a wave coming over you.
Yeah.
And then the other day I decided to walk away.
Yeah.
It's not the good decision.
It was not a good decision,
but Thankfully, I went to the local council after a few months on the street, thinking there's got to be somewhere I can, you know, get myself back up again. And they introduced me to Glassdoor.
Yeah.
Without Glassdoor, I dread to think where I could have been. I dread to think.
So your fate changed. So you had an accident.
Yes,
you fell down
correct.
Some stairs.
Yeah, I had. I broke my neck. Unfortunately, I broke my neck and my back. You know, the accident caused problems for me with everything.
Work,
everything, you know, no job, nothing, you know, so and that was a problem, how it all started, with the neck break.
And then it became a bit much, you left, because you were just like, it's going wrong,
Everything became overwhelmed. I was overwhelmed with all the pressures of all different directions.
Yeah.
So, unfortunately, I didn't know what to do, so I went onto the streets. It's not a good decision, but a lot of people do it because they feel it's their escape.
What was it like being on the streets?
Well, I've never been on there. It's very, very, it's a very strange environment because there's nobody around. You know, nobody, I didn't tell my friends, anybody that was on the streets. Daytimes, you walk around, you've got no money to keep walking around. Unfortunately, circumstances today are more problematic for homeless people because of COVID-19. The library's closing down early and etc. Where I was allowed to get in the library at 9 o'clock and and be able to leave at 8 o'clock in the evening.
Yeah.
That kills half of the day.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Kills half of the day. With the circumstances we live in today, homeless people are in big trouble.
Right.
I mean, and also to track the COVID virus, but again, the government got to look at homeless people because they're moving around all the time. There's no track and trace.
Yeah,
right? A lot of homeless people got an app or a phone, you know, they haven't got that.
No.
It's another big worry.
How did sleeping on the streets affect you psychologically?
I found at night time sleep was very patchy because every time I heard a sound, I'd wake up.
Yeah.
So psychologically, you won't get no sleep. You know, you think you're asleep, but you're not asleep. Do you understand?
Yeah.
And then the days become longer.
Yeah.
You know, and obviously it's going to affect your mental health, you know.
Yeah.
And was I depressed? Obviously it must be moments like downer, like, you know, you lose that link and you get a bit down about it. Yeah. But you have to
Why didn't you tell your friends? So you said that you didn't tell your friends.
No, I didn't tell nobody, no.
Why didn't you?
Probably embarrassment, a bit of embarrassment about being in the position I was in and a bit shameful in a way. No, you do that. People get embarrassed and shameful.
Even though it was just a quirk of fate.
Yeah, a quirk of fate. But people feel that way. They, you know, they, you know, they, what's the word? Pride. You feel pride.
Yeah.
Not, you know, but at the end of the day, you're suffering because of the pride. So people should talk and communicate and try and find avenues.
So do you think as well people make real judgments about people who are affected by homelessness?
Oh yeah, people are very judgmental. Very judgmental. I noticed that. You know, I would never walk past a homeless person myself personally and look down on them because I know what it's like to be there.
Yeah.
But people are judgmental and they look down on you sometimes. Yeah. And some people can be problematic about it.
Oh, yeah. I loved in your VT that you were saying on the video that's on the website how it was really important to you to have like a shave every couple of days. It just really kind of helps you. And Melissa said you used to turn up with like a tie on.
Well, what it was, I used to go to a toilet in a park in Wandsworth. There's a park toilet. And one day I got caught by the cleaner. And he was trying to work out. He couldn't understand why the toilet was so clean every time he arrived to do the cleaning. Because I had been there before.
Yeah.
I used to clean the toilet. Didn't clean myself, you know. I was a bit, you know, a bit tidy, a bit, you know. House proud in a lavatory. And he couldn't believe that every time he turned up he was cleaner.
you took pride in it. That's a good thing. Mm. How did Glassdoor impact on you? How did it help?
Oh, no, Glassdoor, the organisation, changed hell of a lot. Not only that, it's so valued because there was one night I was on the I was in a bus station sleeping. I think it was Hammersmith. And the temperature went down to about -3 degrees. And believe me, it was cold. I felt cold. And then I ended up having to walk around all night, you know. But without Glassdoor, I've not got my, where I am now, I've got a roof over my head.
Have you?
Got a roof over my head. I keep in contact with the organisation. And if I can always help them out, I bend over backwards to help them out. And I'm very grateful, because without Glassdoor,
I'm so glad things have changed, turned around.
Oh yeah, and I did get work, but because of my medical status at the moment, because of injuries, unfortunately I had another injury, I'm just waiting for one doctor to give me a clearance for a consultant guy. Give me a clearance and I'll be back in working. And then my fingers are crossed as well.
My fingers are crossed. My fingers are crossed.
I've got my legs crossed as well.
Hey, Dave, what would you say to people watching this live stream? How would you tell them to get involved? Or would you say, you know, what would you advise them to do? What's your message to them?
What I would say to people who see this, never believe that you can never be homeless, because you never know what can go on in life.
Yeah.
It can happen to anybody. Yeah. I never thought it would happen to me, but it happened. So always remember, never look on anybody on the street door, because you never know, it could be you one day.
Oh, I wish you so much. Look, I'm crossing everything now as well. Make me cross it all. Thank you for joining us.
Oh, thank you very much for your time. I appreciate it.
Let's get another hat. Come on, we need to be your hat twins.
Okay.
I think, you know, if you want to donate, and I'm sure you do, again, I know times are incredibly hard, but every little helps. Go to our website, glassdoor.org.uk/donate. Let's have a look at a quote from someone else who was affected by homelessness. Let me read this out for you. I became visible, sneered at, verbally assaulted, pointed at by children why they held their noses. My first experience as homeless was at a time where support was not available. Not entitled was a phrase I came to identify with. Asking for help would have endless referrals, all with the answer, you are not entitled. I walked a lot. You don't know what the next step is. Am I walking to the library? Am I trying to find a shower? Time is reduced to the next instant. Being homeless makes you more vulnerable, especially for a woman. You are living without knowing what your next step can be. You can be mugged, you can be raped. You can be forced to do things you don't want to do. You close your eyes because you're doing things you don't want to do. Maybe if you want to volunteer at Glassdoor and help us across the year, through the year, not just on sleep out nights, this is how you can do that.
I have seen what good can come when organisations on the front line, like Glassdoor Homeless Charity, have the support they need to help people keep off the streets.
Glassdoor is here to help.
We're here to let them know that they're not on their own.
Because no one should have to sleep on the streets of London.
We are working to help people access benefits more quickly.
Caseworkers like myself are helping people find a permanent place to live.
Staff and volunteers at Glassdoor are doing all they can to support people beyond homelessness.
Our teams will continue to work year round to help support people out of homelessness.
Please give whatever you can, and together we can move towards a future where no one has to sleep on the streets in London.
Go to glassdoor.org.uk to find out more.
Thank you.
We've got another great guest. I've got envy, obviously, already at the bling. I'm happy to introduce the Royal Borough of Kensington and Chelsea Mayor, Councillor Gerard Hargreaves. Hello.
Good evening. How are you?
How are you?
Very well, thank you.
It's so good that you're here tonight.
Great. Well, fantastic opportunity.
Yeah. Why is it so important to you to be here?
Well, when I was elected mayor earlier in May, one of the first tasks I did was to appoint Glassdoor as a mayor's charity for this year.
Yeah.
I'm a Chelsea councillor, so I know the great work that Glassdoor does, and I really want to come and support it. So here I am tonight, giving my support.
You know, I want to ask how much that weighs.
It weighs a lot.
Too much. How do you think the community can help attempt to, I mean, can you eradicate homelessness, but what can we do?
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, we've got a great opportunity here in Chelsea for people to volunteer, people to donate, and people just to spread the word about the good work that Glassdoor does. We have a lot of churches that make their spaces available to Glassdoor, and I think it really is embedded in the community in this area, in Kensington, Chelsea, and people really support it.
Is that, and the churches down here that join in, is that specifically down here? Does that happen anywhere else in London?
I think there are other organisations that do similar things.
It's such a great model.
It is fantastic, you know. I mean, I think every night when the winter shelters are on, there's something like 170, 180.
Yeah.
People sleep in, they get an evening meal, they get breakfast. But as importantly, they get support in terms of finding jobs, in terms of finding homes.
Yeah.
So it's not just the bed for the night, it's the whole package.
Yeah. And Well, I mean, already we talked to James, and if you heard James' story, I mean, just extraordinary in how Glassdoor kind of turned his life around. And we're talking later to Eddie, who I've interviewed before, and Eddie's story is just, you know, it's that important. Yes. It changes people's lives. How are you feeling about sleeping out?
Well, excited. I'm sure in the morning when I'm a bit damp and grumpy, I might have a different view.
Do you know, I did it last year, and it took me about 2 days to recover. And I'm,
don't tell me that now.
No, no, I'm sorry. But I'm just a wuss. But the point is, people do this every night.
Yes, yeah, and that's the thing. The thing I have to remember. Tomorrow, I say, when I wake up a bit damp and grumpy, I'm going to go home to my bed.
Yeah.
You know, and I'll sleep on my own bed tomorrow night. And there are a lot of people who don't have that opportunity. Yeah. And that's what Glassdoor gives them, the opportunity of a warm, dry place at night and food.
There was a really lovely BT earlier, and I bet it will be on the website, and people can have a look later and have a look later, just saying, and it wasn't just how Glassdoor helps the guests, but it's really lovely for the people that work at Glassdoor, actually. It's a really kind of moving and special thing to do.
But you see people progress, don't you? You see them come from being on the street, and you see them gradually progress and rebuild their lives, and that's got to be fantastic.
Yeah. Where are you going to sleep out?
We're sleeping down in Chelsea, one of the church courtyards down in Chelsea.
Did you bring a pillow?
I brought a pillow, I brought a sleeping bag, I brought plastic bags, I brought thermal underwear, I brought tops.
I have faith in you, you can do it.
Left the army 30 years ago to avoid getting wet, and here I am now.
That's hilarious. Were you in the army?
It was a long time ago, yes.
What's being there like?
It's great. I mean, it gives you the opportunity of really learning about the borough. So today I've been with a Moroccan group, tomorrow I'm doing a church planting scheme, I'm doing the Society of Sculptors tomorrow. You see lots of different organisations all contributing in their own way, and that's fantastic.
It's really lovely to meet you.
And to meet you.
I hope you're okay tomorrow.
We'll see. Thank you very much.
Okay. Now we're going to go to a VT of Who We Help.
Inspiration.
Dignity.
Safety.
Community.
Shelter.
Warmth.
Valued.
Passionate.
Opportunity.
Kindness.
Flexible.
Future.
Friendship.
Respect.
Change.
Glassdoor is special because our doors are open to everyone.
Glassdoor is special because we restore people's dignity.
Glassdoor is special because they give me a support.
Glassdoor is special because we serve good food made with love.
Glassdoor is special because it's a safety net for those who have nowhere else to go.
Glassdoor is special because it provides a sense of community to the people that come.
Glassdoor is special because it gives people the inspiration to return to employment.
Glassdoor is special because it's opened doors and given me opportunities to move forward.
Glassdoor is special because everybody is treated with respect.
Glassdoor is special for me because they became my family.
Glassdoor have helped me and made me feel valued.
Glassdoor is special because of the kindness it shows everyone.
So Glassdoor is special because they're passionate about working with the homeless and with those struggling with poverty. It's not just a job for them.
Glassdoor is special because it's about loving our fellow human beings.
Glassdoor is special because we welcome everyone.
Glassdoor is special because I find warmth, security and safety.
Glassdoor is special because they care about people. They care about me.
To the rain. So if you'd like to donate, go to glassdoor.org.uk and frequently asked questions. There's a menu drop down, and it will help you donate. It'll show you how to donate, and it would also show you everything else. There's like frequently asked questions like how do people help the homeless, and so you can go there and it will give you all that information. The information it hasn't got right now on the site, but we've got it for you now, is how much money we've raised. Let's have a little look. amount raised to date, £105,000. This is just brilliant. We, of course, I mean, I'm not greedy, but I want more. I need to keep myself in these gorgeous red things. I have two more guests with me. Yeah, you've got the hats. Everyone's got a hat except me. I'm really happy to introduce the Glassdoor Chair of Trustees and Pastor at St. Luke's Church, Chelsea. And that's Brian Leithard. Hello, yep. How nice to see you. And CEO of Glassdoor, Lucy Abraham. Hi, hello, both of you.
Hi.
How important was it to make sure that Sleep Out happened this year?
So massively important. I mean, Sleep Out is always a huge part of our fundraising year, but this year more than ever, we know that the demand for our services this winter is going to be so high, and meanwhile keeping everybody safe from COVID is going to be so much more costly, so this year is especially important.
And we've built up a huge fan base, people who really enjoy the Sleep Out, yeah, and who want to participate, so that was another reason we thought we may have to tweak it, we may have to find other ways of doing it, but we must do it because we've got fantastic momentum from our volunteers.
Exactly that, and you want to keep that. And people do come back and back from the BT earlier. It's like, you know, it's my third year, it's my fourth year. Yeah. Brilliant. Yeah.
The people that have done it every year.
Since 2013.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know if my back could do that. I mean, I'll try my best. I know we're saying there's going to be a huge rise in figures, but do we have any idea what the figures actually will be?
It's not really clear exactly what it's going to look like this winter. Shelter said a little while ago that they were expecting up to 250,000 people to be at risk of losing their tenancy. So just at the end of last month, the protections that were stopping people from being able to be evicted, that ban finished. We're expecting lots of people to be losing their jobs this winter as the furlough scheme winds down. So we really are expecting that more than ever before people are going to be needing our services.
And what happened to the initiative that people affected by homeless were homed and put in shelters? That seemed to last for 2 months, didn't it? And then everyone...
So the government's Everyone In initiative, they did bring everybody in to hotels almost overnight, and it was a fantastic opportunity for many of our guests to have that sort of stable base, and lots of those people are now in housing, but of course not everybody was able to stay in the hotels, and there are just so many more people that have joined the streets since then, sadly. So our caseworkers have carried on working throughout the summer, throughout the lockdown, and they're seeing new people coming in all the time.
Brian, when did St. Luke's get involved?
Sorry?
When did St. Luke's get involved?
When did
St. Luke's get involved?
Right from the very beginning. So the initiative for Glassdoor, that used to be called West London Church's Homeless Concern, came out of a 20 years ago. There was a question about what should churches in Chelsea be doing to care for our community, and the big sort of screaming issue that everybody was united around was homelessness, and so churches began to work together, which is why it had its original rather clunky name, and why a few years ago we kept the ethos but changed the name. So it spread. I mean, it began through the churches, but it spread far and wide beyond the churches. And lots of people volunteer, lots and lots of people are behind us, whether they've got any faith or not. That for us, that doesn't matter. The point is that there is massive, scandalous homelessness in our community, and we have to get together to fight against it.
It's having faith in people, isn't it? That's the point. What can we do about homelessness? I mean, what do you think should be done? I guess you're not a political... I mean, I don't know how...
Well, no, I mean, you touched just now on the scheme in which lots of people came into hotels, and actually that showed that the collective will is there, that if the right resources are in place, it is possible. But really the challenge is the underlying causes of homelessness, and that's a much sort of longer term game, if you like. So there's still a massive shortage of affordable housing, there's not enough support for people suffering with mental health issues and addictions. So really, you know, there are so many underlying causes of homelessness. But we believe everybody involved in Glassdoor, our vision is a London where no one has to sleep on the streets.
When you don't have a job.
Exactly.
We want to stop. We'd love to stop For the right reasons.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just incredible, isn't it, that, well, I mean, we were the fifth, we're now the sixth wealthiest nation, that homelessness is a thing here, and it seems to be rising. I moved out of London. When I come back to London, I'm blown away by it. I'm in Brighton, and that's even, you know, it's like, it's everywhere. But Sleep Out, the people behind it and people behind Gloucester, that must raise your spirits, that just must make you think, okay, good stuff can happen.
And you know, people really care about it. I mean, that's what our volunteer basis proves to us, that people do care about homelessness quite fundamentally. And also, I think people realise that actually, even if we think we're secure, a lot of our guests, we now realise, you know, have come into homelessness quite by accident, one or two circumstantial changes, a late rent payment, a broken relationship. All those are triggers to homelessness, and they can happen to every single one of us.
Yeah, it's terrifying.
You know, we're all, in a sense, one or two steps away from homelessness. Yeah. That's the great sadness.
It's the paycheck line, isn't it? Yeah. What would be your message then to people tonight watching?
Well, just a massive thank you. First of all, thank you for everyone that's taken part. Thank you for everyone that's supported. And you know, keep up the good work, keep on spreading the word. As you say, an event like this, it's not just about raising the funds, but it's also about raising awareness. It's about people realizing that this is what it's like, you know, when you're sleeping on the streets. It's cold, it's wet, it's miserable, and actually, you know, it's really important that people do understand that.
I think I would say that, you know, every small step can make change when you work together. Working together is greater than the sum of the parts, and we can change this. We can.
Oh, thank you so much for joining us tonight. Where are we all sleeping out?
Sorry?
Where are we all sleeping out?
So I'm going to be sleeping outside my front door.
That's what
back
I'm
at home.
I emailed my neighbours, and it's me.
Yeah.
I'll just be there, you know.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for joining us. And
you,
stay, keep around, because we've got an amazing lineup. So here's who else is coming up this evening. And coming up very soon, we're going to have Colin Firth. I call him Colin, but you lot will know him as Colin Firth. Colin's coming on the show as well. I think he's reading us a poem. Dear Bibi, what rhymes with Bibi? Colin Firth is joining us later, Jim Carter, and it's a great lineup. And Paul Canoville, former Chelsea player Paul Canoville, who wrote an amazing book. We'll talk about that later, but it's an extraordinary story. And so now it's Elizabeth. Elizabeth Healey is going to join us, and Elizabeth has been talking to Ben and Steve.
With Steve Gamble and Ben Davis, two long-standing shelter managers at Glassdoor. Ben, can you tell me what it's like, a typical night in a shelter?
It's, imagine sort of 40 people in a very enclosed space living together. We starts about 6:30 in the evening. We'll get a group of volunteers. Glassdoor basically runs on volunteers, which is what this evening is all about. So we'll have a group of volunteers who will be cooking for about 35 to 45 rough sleepers. So the managers will come in, check the venue over for health and safety. That takes about 20 minutes. It'll probably take a lot longer now under COVID and so forth. We'll get people in around 8:30 and get them fed. It'll be a typical meal, three courses, soup, main meal, and then a very nice dessert. We'll try and get people down for sort of about 9:30, 10 o'clock. The manager is there to make sure things run smoothly, make sure that there are no difficulties with difficult guests and so forth. We do, most of the people here are very, very easy. They want to get themselves down to sleep as quickly as possible. But occasionally there is difficulties, and so we're there to make sure that things run as smoothly as possible.
And for people who don't know what a shelter looks like, can you sort of describe it a bit, and what do the guests actually
Me and Steve will be coming in with our vans. We basically have an entire night shelter in a van. So we'll have 35 yoga mats that we can roll out on the floor. We'll have tea, coffee, changes of clothes, a basic first aid kit, toolbox for every eventuality kind of thing. But they'll come in, they'll start arriving at about 7 o'clock in the evening to about 5 to 8. So we have to do a check to make sure that they're okay, whether they're healthy, whether they've got symptomatic of COVID, whether they've had alcohol and so forth, and we make a judgment call. Some of us are harder on the guests than others. Steve,
looking at me now.
Yeah, it's true. Steve's a lot more hardcore than I am. But you know, we try and keep as many people in. We want people to arrive. We want people to have a good time. We want people to be safe. We also have a duty of care to our volunteers. We, as I said earlier, we run on volunteers. It doesn't work without the generosity of parishioners and people from the surrounding area, you know, from Chelsea, Wandsworth, places like that. So we'll be gathering people in. The area will probably be about the size of about 2 tennis courts, so we'll have 30 men, probably 5 to 10 women in separate areas around the building. So we'll try and get them to sleep as quickly as possible. They will have been on the streets and, you know, up and at them. The previous night shelter would have finished at 7 o'clock in the morning. So on a day like today, especially when there's nothing open, these guys will be cold, tired, wet, bad tempered. We tend to think of the homeless people as a kind of homogenous mass, but they're 30 to 35 individuals with their own stories and with their own problems.
And do you find that they come back time and time again?
Yes, unfortunately. You know, what we would like, you know, at the end of the season, me and Steve will always say to somebody, I don't want to ever see you again. Because, you know, hopefully they'll get themselves into accommodation. Our accommodation team are absolutely brilliant at placing people. But yeah, unfortunately there are... Yeah, I've not been doing the night shelter for 2 years, you know, full time, but I can sort of say, I can guess probably there'll be half a dozen people who are see back and going, oh, still here again, but there we are.
And Steve, how many years have you been a shelter manager?
I think, I'm back again this year, it'll probably be my 12th year.
Yeah.
Wow,
yeah.
12
yeah.
years. And what is the atmosphere like? What's the mood like in the shelter?
The atmosphere is it's excellent, actually. Most of the time, the atmosphere is really good. It's a jovial atmosphere. People are very happy to be inside rather than out on the street in a wet night like this. The atmosphere is twofold. It's also the interaction between the guests and our volunteers. So it's usually a very good vibe between the two. It can sometimes be a bit fractious, but that's very rare. Most of the time, it's a very good atmosphere. People are just happy to be able to come in, have a nice hot meal, nice three-course meal, sit down, have a chat with friends that you might not have seen throughout the day, have a good chat, catch up with them, and have, a good interaction with the volunteers. Our volunteers are absolutely superb. Without them, it just wouldn't be the same.
And a night like this, I mean, it just shows how important a shelter is. I mean, of you and me have got the option of going back to our homes.
We can go back to our bed. At 10 o'clock, I'll finish my shift and go back to my own bed. Unfortunately, the people we have haven't got that luxury.
And what is it, gentlemen, that keeps you coming back year after year?
Year after year. I look forward to the first week in November, because it's like going somewhere and being introduced to a new family. Yeah. And that's what it's like throughout the whole season. It becomes your family. Yeah. And you look after them, you care for them for the 5 months of the year. And like I said, and as Ben said, you hope at the end of the season that you don't see them again. But you always see one or two.
One or two, they're always back. Yeah.
And it's catching up again.
Yeah, what Steve said.
It's like one big family. It is a family.
Yeah. It's just, having done this, I came... 9 years ago as a temp. I was going to do one season, and you know, these people are now my extended family. These are the people who I look forward to coming back. You know, we do a lot of us do lots of different work during the summer. I go off and work for a company called St Mungo's. Steve works for a great place called the Ace of Clubs. But we all, come October, November time, we'll be phoning each other up. What's going on this year? What's going on? Who's going to be back? Who's going to be working with whom and stuff like that? It's just, and the ethos of the place is so good. I do management work for 6 months a year. I'm a pen pusher. Coming back here, this is the cutting edge. What makes Glassdoor unique is that we work with everybody. Most light shelters will have a criteria of who can come in and who can't come in. We work with absolutely everyone. We don't turn people away.
Open door policy.
Yeah, absolutely.
We do work with everybody. We love to work with everybody. And like I said, there's lots, just like me and Ben, who come back year after year after year. There's a few. I think
we're comparatively new. I mean, there are a couple of guys who have been working for the thing since, the late 1990s. So, you know, there are people who have come back.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, Bruce, God knows how old Bruce is these days.
About
yeah, about 105.
One of
the night shelter managers, you know, was grey-haired when I turned up 9 years ago. He's white-haired now. He's like a very jovial Canadian Santa Claus. And he comes back year after year after year. And, we're not here for the money particularly. We're here because...
We care.
It's a really easy way to help people, and that's what could be better than that?
One volunteer who's been doing it for 21 years now.
Yeah,
right from the very start, she's been volunteering, and she'll be back again this year to do something.
Of the 25 people who'll be coming tonight, I bet you she's one of the people.
She'll be here.
Yeah.
What's her name?
Rosie.
Right.
Yes, we both knew. Yeah, Rosie MBE or OBE.
I'm not sure if she's
granddaughter of something. Yeah, Rosie's one of those people who will turn up. What can I do? How can I help? How can we make this calm? How can we make this better?
And she volunteers in at least three different shelters.
Yeah, yeah.
So, gentlemen, this is going live to all sorts of people watching. Some are volunteering, some who are participating tonight. What would you say to them about?
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And on a night like tonight, you're very, very brave.
Yeah.
But the biggest thing is that every single penny that you manage to raise is worth everything. Yeah. Every single penny counts.
Yeah.
So the more you raise, the more we have.
We want a very lean ship here. Very, very tight.
Yeah.
It doesn't go on management and stuff like that. Mm. The money that you raise here directly funds the stuff that we work. The more awareness, the more money that we raise here, is the more people we can help. When I was started here 9 years ago, we had three shelter circuits. We've got five this year. We're looking to get open six.
There's one when I started.
Yeah, well, there you are. Yeah, you know, and it, we've gone from a tiny organisation in a room not much bigger than this giant umbrella that we're under to, you know, a huge organisation. We are the largest single open access night shelter in the country, and we're very, very proud of that. But it doesn't work without the volunteers, and it doesn't work without the fundraisers.
We've done our bit of fundraising as well.
Yes, we cycled to Paris about four years. Is it really 4 years?
It's to celebrate my 60th.
Oh God, you were 60 and I was the idiot who fell off on the second day. So there we are. Yeah.
Wonderful, gentlemen. Thank you so much. Have a good night.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Bye bye.
That was Elizabeth chatting with Ben and Steve. Elizabeth will be back later. So please, if you want to donate, and we wish you would, we need to get these figures up. If you would like to make a difference, then please donate whatever you can. Any amount helps. Head to our website, glassdoor.org.uk/donate. You think I'd be able to say that by now? glassdoor.org.uk/donate. The rain is still here, so if there's any glitches going on, we have to blame the rain, okay? And also, the rain makes an important noisy point of its own, because we're sleeping out later and it's like, yeah, it's wet, it's wet, it's awful. This is how people live. This is how they have to be. Yeah, Paul's nodding. This is what it's like for them a lot of the time. And if it's hideous, the thought of us doing it tonight and it messing up with our sound and stuff like that, if that's irritating, try living it, okay? It's awful. Paul, you're nodding.
I am, because it's ironic, as you said, that it had to happen. It had to be raining on a day, it's non-stop.
Yeah.
And I know that those that are homeless now are seeking, you know what I mean, refuge and food.
Where are they going?
Exactly. Yeah. And this is what they've got to look for.
I didn't give you proper instruction.
I didn't, you didn't.
I'm going to do it now.
It don't matter.
It does matter.
Okay.
It does matter. So I'm delighted to introduce Chelsea's first black player, author of the award-winning book Black and Blue, Amazing Reviews, Racism, Drugs and Cancer Almost Destroyed Me, and motivational speaker, the inspirational King Canners, Paul Canoville.
Hey, pleasure to be here. It was a pleasure joining you last year, Glassdoor. I'd like to say hello to Mark Meehan, because if it wasn't for him, I wouldn't be here at all. And we gave the support, and we're sleeping out last year, and don't get me wrong, it was colder than this.
Yeah, and I was here last
that
year.
That was just an experience for me, again, to feel that pull.
Yeah.
Where you've gone, how far I've come from.
Yeah.
But it's never too far from my head, obviously, the concern for the people. And not just elderly, the youngsters as well. you've got to be concerned.
See, your story is extraordinary, and we haven't unfortunately got 10 hours because I'd love to talk to you about all of this. Let's go back over some of it, though, because we have to. What was it like being the first black player at Chelsea? I know there's some really bad stuff, but was there some lovely stuff?
You know what? The excitement for me was always going to be following a dream, and that was to be a professional footballer. You don't think of nothing else at that time. Oh, don't get me wrong. Your parent or your mum wants you to get an education, but football was always ingrained in me. And to achieve that, it was great. To happen to be at Chelsea Football Club, but I didn't know the history. But I wasn't about to let it beat me or allow it to take away my dream. So I continued, and it was always like difficult, because when I came away from there, it was like, what can I do? I was like blaming myself. What can I do better? What can I do right? And it was always
talking about the racism.
Yeah, it was just trying to get acceptance.
Yeah.
And that was the hardest thing, just to let them see how good I am.
Yeah.
And I'm playing for you, your team. But
so yeah, it was your own fans. It's so mad.
It was difficult, don't get me wrong. And everybody repeatedly talks about it with me. Paul, how did you go through that? Yeah. And why? And I think that's got to be part of my mum, who came over the Windrush, and how difficult it was for her, for a young black woman, and work, trying to find work, and obviously her colour getting in the way of things. But she never gave in, and that was probably where it's come from. I couldn't give in, so yeah, that's where we are.
What was your proudest footballing moment?
Proudest moment, everybody would tell you, would be Sheffield Wednesday League Cup, 1985. Losing 3-0, and I'm coming on at half-time, scoring in 11 seconds, and scoring two goals where the game ended 4-4. One of the greatest comebacks, I would have said, in Chelsea's history. And I was there, and probably from that game, that's when I got the support from fans.
Was that it?
Yeah, definitely.
Finally.
Yeah, you could say that, you know? You could say that.
That's so amazing. And then, though, but you were really young when you had to retire.
I did, in my peak, 25, which was daunting. Very difficult for me to accept. When you're 25, that's the start of your life in football, to be honest. Everybody can tell you who's been in the game. And it was taken away from me. An unfortunate accident. I thought I could get back, but I wasn't the same player. And I think from there, really, I went downhill, a little spiral. In denial, to be honest, and because I think my mental well-being that I wasn't aware of was taken over, and I got myself unfortunate in drugs, and I thought that would take away part of the miserable life I was living, but it wasn't taking it away, it was just staying there, and I was getting worse, where at time my health, I wasn't looking after it, and then next thing, diagnosed with cancer, and the next thing, diagnosed with cancer. It was just, you know what, one after the other, whether the man above was just giving me a test, or letting me to know that, boy, you can fight and come out of this. That's probably where I am today.
Well, you're a motivational speaker now, and actually, does that kind of make some kind of sense of what you did go through?
It helps. It certainly helps that I experienced all that. As much as people say, oh my God, that was difficult, but that's why I say, maybe he's given me that reason so I'm able to share those experiences, and not just the elderly, the youngsters. They need to know, I didn't have a mentor when I was growing up. My father wasn't around. So now I'm able to mentor those young kids with my foundation, the Paul Canoville Foundation. And it's haunts me as a person, as a man, that I can look at responsibilities and look at things deeply as well, not just about the others, about myself as well. And it's helping, most definitely.
Part of you had all this kind of life happen, didn't you? All this kind of stuff happened, being tested. Part of that was becoming homeless.
It was, and at a young age as well. And
how old were you?
I was starting to, just before I was at Chelsea, and an altercation happened with my mum's partner, and which was his house, and he just at that time told me to get out. I didn't even think about it. I didn't think of anything. Well, where am I going? Because I actually didn't have nowhere to go. Now, at that time, my mum was at work, so she didn't know what was going on. So she thought I'd just left the house and didn't say nothing. So it was a case of now walking the street and not telling anybody. And the next thing you know, it came late in the evening, late in the night, and you realise, where am I going to stay tonight? It was only by chance that I remembered the next door neighbour to the house, that my friend had his car outside in the garage at the back, that I chose to go in and sleep in the car. And at times, the car was more colder inside there than outside. It was like you had to come out, and then the thought pattern was, where am I going to get food now?
Yeah.
I can't even knock anybody north, because I had the one family. There was my sister and my mum. My sister was a young lady girl that was pregnant, and I even had to go part to her. I think it was mother's hostel that they weren't allowed any males in there. I had to knock her window to get some food. But yeah, those are difficult times. I'll never, ever forget them. And this is where we are today, to realise how it's not got any easier. Because right now,
it's not going to get easier.
Oh, it's not. And this is why I can't understand. And I'm not an MP, but how can the government not look at this? This is serious now. You've got people, young people, when I say young girls, young boys now, sleeping rough. You just don't know what's going to happen.
It's that whole Maslow's hierarchy of needs, that kind of psychological pyramid of what you need to survive and what people need to survive. The bottom layer is security and warmth. And
it's amazing, because it was just like I was talking to a young colleague over there, and it was just like, when you see people and you see them sleeping rough, your first thought is not to understand, well, why is he in that situation? Your first is just seeing, oh my gosh, he's a tramp. Well, she's a tramp. No, it's beyond that. Why do you think he's there? Why do you think she's there? And that's what you've got to think about. You're not, this is the ignorance about us, really. And you know what I mean? If you won't understand it if you've not been there. You've got to understand, you've got to talk with somebody to really.
That's why you're brilliant as a motivational speaker then, because you kind of, you are saying it. What's your message to anyone watching tonight?
You know what, please, this is so serious, this is special to me, donate. Make that donation to help. Glassdoors, we've done a tremendous job last year, but I know we could do better this year. So it's up to you people out there, you're listening, you're looking. Please, pass it on, make a donation.
So Paul, we raised some money. Should we have a little look?
Have we done?
Let's have a look. Read it out for me when it comes up. Oh, it's coming.
Glass door, sleepover, 220. Oh, I like that. 117,000. Oh my gosh.
That is brilliant.
Great. You know what? That is brilliant. I didn't even expect that. You know what? We made a little Duncan on with the Chelsea boys that done well last year. But this is tremendous. You know what? Keep coming. And keep donating, keep passing the word. It's really important.
So we've got, this is just brilliant, isn't it? So the people raising this, they're on Twitter and they're on Facebook, and they've been sending in great photos and great posts.
Great.
Let's have a little look at them. So these are the people that are bringing in the money. Who's that? Looking fabulous.
I'm loving that mask and I'm loving that hat. Yeah. I don't know where my hat went to, but she's got to take, show me that one.
Beautiful.
I love that. Oh, that's brilliant.
That's St Mary's Church.
Oh, brilliant.
That looks like the White House. I'm sure that can't be the White House.
What a change.
They've raised £1,500 already. Okay, this is so
Don't mind my cut legs, you know.
Yeah, what's that
just,
about?
No, it was I couldn't get a trousers or iron a trousers in time. So look, I know I'm going to get some stick canners. What are you doing with them, please? It's not about canners. Anyway.
So you know you're a heartthrob?
Yeah. Am I? Trees. What? With his top?
Of course you are. There's another heartthrob coming up.
Go on.
His first name's Colin. Firth.
Oh, I like
Firthy.
Love him as an actor.
Do you?
Watch him up. Love him as an
Do
actor.
You?
I think there's... Oh, God. Because I'm terrible with names. Anyway, go. Come
he's
on.
Gonna read us,
it's coming.
He's going to read us a poem, I think.
Oh, brilliant.
Let's have a look.
Hello. I'm reading this in support of Glassdoor, a charity who support people in need of shelter and who support people in the move beyond homelessness. This is also for everybody participating in the Sleep Out. It's a poem called Homeless Man by C.J. Heck. Homeless man, I watched you lie in a deserted doorway. Your Maytag boxes, cardboard monuments in FedEx labels and signs pointing this side up. Stark reminders of what is and what could be, but for the grace of God. I wondered if I wished hard enough, a FedEx truck might spirit you away on a magic carpet ride to where you wouldn't be invisible. For those who take the time to look and really see. To where someone would offer you a job with no catch 22. First telling you to shower and having clean clothes, and you with no money for either without a job. I wished, I prayed, but for the grace of God go I.
I'm just going to look dreamily at the camera just for a little while, just in case Colin's still looking. No? Okay, nothing from Colin. That was Colin Firth giving us a little poem to make us all dreamy and sleepy and lovely. Listen, you're still going to donate. You've still got time. I mean, we've hit that ridiculous amount, but we can go higher. If you'd like to make a difference, then please donate. When, whatever you can, head to our website, glassdoor.org.uk/donate. So we were rudely interrupted,
yeah.
Edward.
Yeah.
We were talking, and I was asking you about kind of the worst things that happened to you when you were, so you were sleeping on the streets for 26 years. What would you say was the worst thing?
I think when losing your identity, losing who you are as a person.
Yeah.
Do you know, because you don't, you become a nobody, you know what I mean? And you can be in the streets, you can be begging, or you could just be sitting somewhere and getting ignored off people, or people looking down on you, or people judging you. That affects your confidence, affects your self-esteem, it affects your self-worth.
I can't imagine it.
Losing who you are as a person, and I think when we in Glassdoor and we're bringing people in, we give people value, we give people respect. You know, and we get them a place where they can become themselves.
Yeah. How did Glassdoor change your life then? Because you've told me that it turned your life around.
Yeah. But before they gave me a job, they gave me a job. Do you know, that was the first time I'd been in employment ever. Before that, when I used to get for something to eat, and even when I was in hospital, volunteers used to come and visit me in hospital.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and I never knew the people, and they're coming there and they'd be praying for me and just...
That's amazing, isn't it?
You know, not knowing the people, but the people, like I just said a minute ago, to give you value,
yeah.
They show you respect, and within people showing you that, you can identify and find them worth in yourself.
So when you were on the streets, What should people have done to make you feel seen?
I don't think people should ignore people. Do you know, I said to somebody before, when we were on the streets, not to look at what you see. People look at our appearance. I say, look at what somebody could be. Everybody's got potential. Everybody's got value. We don't know who somebody can be. We don't know what they could be capable of being.
Tell me what life's like now for you then. How
life's good, man. Life's good. You know, I've got friends, I've got community. I think we all need to be belonging.
Yeah.
Do you know, we can travel through life, but we've all got a hunger and searching for something. We can look in places, things and peoples and objects, trying to find something, and we never find it. There are always a void, always an emptiness. Do you know, and we're looking for connection with people.
So you told
me
we're
born for connection.
We need connection. No man is an island. No woman is an island. We need that. You told me something that kind of blew my mind. So we won't say where you live, but you live somewhere now that you can look down and see where you used to sleep.
Yeah.
That's just.
Yeah, enough.
How extraordinary is that?
Mm. But where I started in 1984, sleeping in a train depot, people coming on at 6 o'clock in the morning, hosing you down,
to get you off it. I have that flat next to it now. Yeah, and it's crazy, it's surreal, but it's...
I'm so glad things have turned round.
And I've got a job, and I'm clean 9 years.
9 years?
9 years.
Congratulations.
And without this opportunity to change, I'd be dead.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I can say, when I talked to you the last time, and I said about that guy that was clean for 18 months, and the amount of people that it's gave opportunity.
Yeah.
To move out for this situation,
yeah.
And have a start in life.
I think it's, you know, just it's extraordinary how you've turned stuff around, and with the help of Glassdoor, but also because of you, and it's so lovely to see you again.
Nice to see you.
Stay there, because there's a great BT coming up. So Elizabeth, the lovely Elizabeth, has been out and about, and she was talking to John Shepherd. Watch this and enjoy it.
I'm with John Shepherd, who's the owner of Partridge's Market here in Duke of York Square. John, tell me, how did you get involved in this event? Because you do it every year, don't you?
We do, yes. We've been doing it since 2013, and we've been a retailer in this location for 49 years now. And we always like to get involved in local events and activities and good causes. And this was one of those that we first found out about in 2013. And it's been great being involved as a part of it, even though we play only a small part.
Well, I don't know if it is a small part, because I think you provide food, don't you?
Too, yes.
Where we're not in lockdown and COVID isn't here, this square is sort of full of people
sleeping. It is. It would be full right now, I think, with people arriving. It's a bit sad, but fully understandable. It can't take place this year. So each year we provide this sort of breakfast at 5 a.m. in the morning, which is a bacon sarnie and a vegan sausage sandwich and a cup of coffee to all the night sleeper outers who come here. And very enjoyable it is too.
And what do you get out of doing this work?
Well, it's, as I say, it's always nice to be part of the local community and do events with the local community, but the staff actually really enjoy doing it as well. And they're led by one of my colleagues called Aziz, who's indefatigable in this matter. He's so dedicated to doing providing as many breakfasts as possible for everyone. And they arrive at 3 o'clock in the morning and says prepare, and basically start serving at 5. And all in all, a lot of the sleeper outers are local people who we know very, very well, local characters, local vicars, and all sorts of people like that. So it's a great community vibe going on. And the community vibe mixed with the smell of coffee and bacon drifting across the Duke of York Square on an autumnal morning is one of Chelsea's great experiences. And in human contact terms, probably one of London's great experiences as well. And so, you know, it's all thanks to Glassdoor and, of course, the Cadogan Estate who allow us to do all of this. It's a brilliant experience, so that we all love doing it and we wouldn't miss it.
So it sounds to me it's a real win-win, isn't it?
It is.
Great for you, it's great for the participants.
Well, it's a great charity to support as well, because it's local too. And homelessness is a local problem here, but it's also a London-wide problem. And we're all Londoners, and most of us who work in the shop are local people too. Glassdoor are an amazing charity. And reading on their website, you know, how bad the situation is with homelessness, we tend to forget about it. I personally thought it might be getting better, but it's getting a lot worse. It's doubled in the last decade, for example. And what really struck me was the statistic of the life expectancy of people. You know, it's probably 77 and 80 for men and women in this country. But for rough sleepers, it's 47 and 43 for women. And that's 30 years of their life lost. And the other thing about Glassdoor, it's really an open door, because it is offering help and support alongside shelter and food, but to anyone regardless of background and who they are. And that's really, really very important for us too. So it's a great charity to be involved with.
And John, finally, what message would you give to the people who are participating this year?
Well, I think thanks to everyone who's participating this year. I think it's needed more than ever this year than any other year before, actually, because COVID has made it very difficult for charities like Glassdoor to do what they normally do with all the restrictions and regulations, and so the support is even more vital. So anyone who's at home now, going to sleep on the floor or the sofa.
Or in the bath.
In the bath, yes, absolutely. Thank goodness, well done, bless you, and it's great to have your support. And sorry we can't give you a bacon sandwich this year. But we'll do it next year.
I was going to say, they'll have to come back next year, won't they?
Absolutely.
And taste your bacon sarnie.
Exactly. And many years to come, hopefully.
Oh,
and
John,
thank you very much, Glassdoor, for allowing us to be a small part of it.
Thank you very much.
Okay, not at all. Thank you. Well done.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for Bibi. That was one. Thanks, Bibi, for passing the baton to me. It's really good to be in the chair. And John was so wonderful, wasn't he? It's people like that that make all the difference to charities like this. So, you know, please, we want you to get involved too. So if you haven't donated, please do. It's so easy. You just have to go to our website, www.glassdoor.org.uk, and just press a button. And please try and encourage other people to do so. We want to get that total as high as we can. And if you're taking part tonight, you're sleeping out or sleeping in, whether you're in the kitchen or in the bathtub, wherever you are, we want to know what you're doing. So send us your tweets, send us your pictures, send us your videos. We really want to see what's happening out there. So yes, you can send them to our Facebook or Twitter accounts, and obviously on hashtag GDSO. So now we're going to be speaking live to Dr. Kat, who is a speech specialist, live from Germany. That is, if the technology works. Dr. Kat, are you there? Yes, there she is. Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Welcome. Where are you calling in from?
I'm in Germany at the moment. I should have been back in London about a week ago, but we had some family issues, so I'm right in the middle of Germany on the farm in the countryside, so it's a beautiful, beautiful place.
Well,
and I have
hope
to
the
say there's no rain here. I'm sort of shocked to hear the rain in the background.
Yes,
where you are.
It's very heavy, but as we were saying earlier, you know, this is exactly why it's important to do these things live, because you can't predict the weather. And, have we lost Dr. Kat? Oh,
no,
there she is.
I'm still here.
Yes, it's so important, isn't it? Because we can't predict the weather, and people who don't have a home to go to, this is what their daily life is like. Dr. Kat, you're an expert in sleep. That's what you do. Can you tell us a little bit more about sleep? We all do it, but we don't really understand why we do it and why it's so important.
Yeah, exactly. That's really important that we all sleep and we all need to sleep. So we all have a sleep experience, right? It's the single most important health behavior that we can all engage in. And why we sleep? We actually don't know the single one function why we sleep, but we know it's important for our general health and well-being, for our physical health, for our sort of cognitive performance and our emotional well-being. And earlier on, I believe it was James who was speaking maybe about an hour ago, and he spoke about how he struggled to sleep and how he struggled to feel safe and how this impacted upon his mood, other things as well, but he mentioned feeling depressed, I think. And this is really what sleep helps us to do, to balance our emotions and our mood. So it's important for many, many different things.
And what is the importance in terms of your mental health? Because without sleep, you were saying that there's depression, a loss of joy de vivre, if you like, and being on the streets, that obviously takes its toll. Over time, lack of good quality sleep must really affect your health in the long term.
Yeah, it does. So on the physical side. Oh, sorry.
I don't know if you can see it, but we're actually getting rain coming into the studio right now.
Oh, dear. So on the physical side, it's important, for example, for the control of our weight, so obesity, diabetes, but it's also important for our immune system. And right now, where we're going into the colder and clearly wetter season, we need our immune system to be as strong as we can be. Sleep there, for example, just thinking of vaccinations, and people might get sort of the flu jab. Sleep's important it's important to sleep well the nights before your vaccination and after, so that antibodies can build up, and so we get the most from it. But as we said, sleep's also important for this emotional side of things. So you will all know, probably, something I do very well, after a poor night or a run of poor nights, I wake up feeling sort of grumpy and moody, and a comment by my husband, you know, about my hair being maybe a bit sort of frizzy or disheveled, typically I'd say, yep, that's fine, hand me the brush, and I'll sort of go, oh, why is he saying this? Why is he attacking me? And sort of react as if I'm being attacked, and so I get aggressive and irritated. Now, if this persists, the poor sleep, this can then become, you know, can sort of develop into depression and anxiety. So we really need that sleep to have a balanced view on life, on what other people are saying to us.
And that's where Glassdoor is so important, isn't it? Because it's giving people a safe place to sleep and to get that good quality sleep for a long period of time, particularly in the months where it's cold and it's really tough to be out here.
Yeah, exactly. And safety is a really important point. Because I work with people who suffer from insomnia, so problems falling asleep or staying asleep. And in the discussions, what often comes through is not feeling safe. Now, for my clients, this is less about sort of physical safety. They have a home, house, or flat. But it made me wonder about people who don't have that security, that very basic security. Like right now, there's the rain. But again, something James was saying, and I think Eddie as well, is sort of, you know, always watching out. Could someone come and beat them or urinate on them? And I remember I read a quote by one of the guests of a lady who sort of slept a few hours here, then went somewhere else, slept there, and tried to always be in sight of CCTV cameras. And so this is constantly interrupted sleep. Not only is this very tiring, again, it will take a toll on how she feels and how she thinks, how she perceives the world.
And is it the different stages of sleep we need to make sure we're getting into? And that's linked to the feeling of safety. If you're in a safe place, you can allow yourself to go into those deeper realms of sleep where you really do start feeling replenished.
Yeah, exactly. So we have light sleep, deep sleep, and REM sleep, or rapid eye movement sleep. And the really restorative part is probably the deep sleep. I mean, we need all sleep stages in the right proportions, but it's sort of that deep sleep where there's a lot of repair that's taking place in the brain and in the body. Whereas if we are feeling unsafe, we remain in these lighter, in the more shallow sleep. And so don't we get that really restorative sort of benefit from sleep?
And do you think that's the case with people sleeping on the streets, is that they don't have the opportunity to get into that place, which again is why Glassdoor is so crucial to their health, their all-round health?
Yeah, exactly, because it takes a moment, you know, to get into that deep sleep. But again, and we know this from studies where people were put up in a hotel room, and here the idea is that it was a novel environment, and you could see that they didn't really get much of that deep sleep, right, because it's novel. And again, if you're on the street and constantly moving, it's probably a very similar situation. So having a shelter, having a home, having a room provided for you where you know nothing can happen to me, that is just simply amazing.
Yeah.
You know, so certainly for me, from a sleep perspective, knowing that these people are sleeping well and getting the benefits from the sleep.
I was just saying, it's a gift that we take for granted every single day, because we have it all the time. And what about the impact of the pandemic on, I mean, it's affected our sleep, I'm sure, for a lot of people anyway, but for the homeless, people experiencing homelessness, that's an added extra, isn't it?
Yeah, it's another worry, because, you know, again, you want your immune system to, you know, be at 100%, and you kind of know, because the way you are living and sleeping, that might not be the case. So you might, you know, have an increased risk of catching the disease, although I don't know, there aren't any studies at the moment, so there's no really data to show this, but it is plausible that certainly the anxiety, I could catch it. Is very high amongst people who don't have a home.
So what would you like to say to the people tonight who are out sleeping or sleeping inside?
Really value your sleep and really see it as something, as almost like a gift. If you have a home and if you have a comfortable bed and a wonderful bedroom where it's warm, you know, that you have this shelter. That allows your body to sort of trust everything is safe and it can disconnect from the environment, so that the body can then all the processes it needs to do to, you know, cleanse your brain, repair any metabolic pathways, restore your emotional balance, your cognitive performance, and you can fully function the next day and you have a good quality of life. Really, yeah, appreciated. And I think wherever we can help other people to get that quality of life as well, we should do it.
Thank you so much for talking to us, Dr. Kat. Right, well, it's really interesting, isn't it, how we just take our sleep for granted
And it, how important it is to recognise that without good sleep, none of us are really very, very well. So what else is coming up this evening? Well, we've seen Colin Firth read a beautiful poem. We've had interviews from people who are working on the front line, as it were. We've got Jim Carter, known from Downton Abbey. He'll be reading us a beautiful bedtime story. Just for midnight, we're going to be hearing live from DJ Northern Boy. And at 6:30, Nadia will be waking us up, refreshed for the weekend, with a beautiful yoga session. And she'll also be popping in to speak to me a little bit later on. Volunteers now, let's see what they're up to.
I have seen what good can come when organisations on the front line, like Glassdoor Homeless Charity, have the support they need to help people keep off the streets.
Glassdoor is here to help.
I'm worried to let them know that they're not on their own.
Because no one should have to sleep on the streets of London.
We are working to help people access benefits more quickly.
Caseworkers like myself are helping people find a permanent place to live.
Staff and volunteers at Glassdoor are doing all they can to support people beyond homelessness.
Our teams will continue to work year round to help support people out of homelessness.
Please give whatever you can, and together we can move towards a future where no one has to sleep on the streets in London.
Go to glassdoor.org.uk to find out more.
Thank you.
Easier, just go to our website glassdoor.org.uk/donate and just press a button. Thank you so much. Every penny absolutely makes a huge difference.
Inspiration,
dignity,
safety,
community,
shelter,
warmth,
valued.
Passionate.
Opportunity.
Kindness.
Flexible.
Future.
Friendship.
Respect.
Change.
Glassdoor is special because our doors are open to everyone.
Glassdoor is special because we restore people's dignity.
Glassdoor is just special because they give me a support.
Glassdoor is special because we serve good food made with love.
Glassdoor is special because it's a safety net for those who have nowhere else to go.
Glassdoor is special because it provides a sense of community to the people that come.
Glassdoor is special because it gives people the inspiration to return to employment.
Glassdoor is special because it's opened doors and given me opportunities to move forward.
Glassdoor is special because everybody is treated with respect.
Glassdoor is special for me because they became my family.
Glassdoor have helped me and made me feel valued.
Glassdoor is special because of the kindness it shows everyone.
So Glassdoor is special because they're passionate about working with the homeless and with those struggling with poverty. It's not just a job for them.
Glassdoor is special because it's about loving our fellow human beings.
Glassdoor is special because we welcome everyone.
Glassdoor is special because I find warmth, security and safety.
Glassdoor is special because they care about people. They care about me.
Well, you can see I've got my coat on now because the weather's getting pretty wild out there. The wind's coming in, the rain's coming in, but we're still going. We're still here. And I hope you are too. I hope you're sticking with us because we've got some great stuff coming up. And right now I'm joined by two very special people, Gemma and Alex, who are caseworkers with Glassdoor. It's an extraordinary thing you do. Tell me, why do you do the work that you do?
I think for me, it's from working in a lot of cities that have a really high number of rough sleepers and always wanting to do something to help. I think working with Glassdoor is a really great way to do that because we have this open door policy. We will work with anybody who is rough sleeping or vulnerably housed. And it's just so interesting and rewarding to be able to help people who are in that situation sort of go through that journey from homelessness to security, safety, being housed.
And you must really start making relationships with these people. And if you're with them through that whole journey, you know, you must get to know them pretty well.
Absolutely. And it's that building of rapport and relationships with the guests that we do work with that is deeply rewarding as well when you're going through the journey from how they are at the beginning and the difficulties that they're facing and knowing that you're the person there for them who can help them and really be there to support them whilst giving them the agency as well to know that everything that's happening is their choice. No one is enforcing them to do anything. We just want to be there to support them in the choices that they want to make.
And that seems to me really, really important, is that actually you're not telling them what to do.
Absolutely.
They're having choice in their future. They're making their own decisions.
Yeah.
It seems you're just coming alongside them and supporting them on that journey. Is that right?
Absolutely. There's also a different guests take a lot longer, especially when we're working with those who've been deeply entrenched. So we're talking 10 years, 15 years, it's quite a daunting thing to then suddenly say, actually, you know, we have a studio flat available for you, when their whole life for decades has been the streets. So definitely different guests work and cope and are at different timescales, and you have to be wary of that. You know, you don't want to enforce anything. You don't want to be like, no, go in now. You know, it's at their own pace and their own decisions. So.
And not one size fits all.
Exactly.
Everyone needs a different kind of solution. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, absolutely.
I think as well, you mentioned that a lot of people have quite entrenched lifestyles because they've been rough sleeping for a very long time. But on the flip side, we see a lot of people who have never been in this situation before in their lives. And especially this year with so many people having been affected by the pandemic. Mm. And I think one of the things that Glassdoor does very well is really explain to people what their options are, because for people who have never faced homelessness before, they just don't know what support is out there, what they're eligible for, what they can access, and what services are out there to help. So it really goes both ways, I think.
Absolutely. Also, I think it's very, for those who it happens and they're like, how has this happened? It really can happen extremely easily, far more easily than you would think.
Can you give me some examples of that you've come across, Gemma?
Losing employment. So if you're in private rented accommodation and everything is completely upon you having a source of income in order to pay that rent, and if you perhaps only have a license agreement rather than a full-on tenancy, the protections that you have to have your own accommodation are far, far less in terms of the law. So you can, within maybe 48 hours, be asked to leave. And if you haven't paid your rent and suddenly it's you've lost your job, you can't pay your rent, and your landlord has decided to actually be like, actually, no, we want you out. We're not going to give you a grace period, and that can happen. And then if people don't have friends that they can sofa surf with, eventually you're calling us, you're calling Glassdoor. And
did you find
help.
that was becoming more common because of the pandemic, because people were self-isolating and they didn't have that backup from family and friends?
I think so. there was so many things that meant that people were more vulnerable during the pandemic. It was partly, as Gemma said, that people were losing their jobs, but people who were housed in places where they didn't necessarily have a written contract, perhaps they were subletting, people just not able to pay their rent anymore and being asked to leave. And that's before you even get into the physical and mental health side of things. And I think one of the things you really notice in this job is just how there are so many different cases of people who face homelessness for reasons that you wouldn't even think of. Like, you can list so many reasons that someone might face homelessness, and then you meet somebody one day and you think, wow, this is such a unique situation. And you have to kind of think of ways to overcome it. It's so difficult for so many people.
And I'm noting you call them guests.
Yeah.
Not clients, or why guests?
Well, I would say it's because we're welcoming them into our service. And especially when we were having the night shelters, it's your guests of our night shelter, and we're working with you. And again, it highlights that agency and that choice. It's, you are our guests, we're working with you to help combat your homelessness and other difficulties that arise from that. And we just feel that it's a far more open and informal way of speaking about those we work with.
And why do you guys do it? I mean, what is it that you... You're both smiling when I say that. Obviously, there's something about it that keeps you doing what you do. I mean, what do you get out of it,
personally? For me, so I was previously working in legal aid, which when I first directly encountered people who were dealing with social injustice. And from that moment on, it was like, I need to make a difference. And when the opportunity to work for Glassdoor came out, it's frontline work, it's doing something directly and feeling that you've done something and you see the person there themselves, you go on that journey. It's very, very personal, and so the rewards that you get out of that, it feels very tangible, even though these things aren't, and you know them. I had a guest call me just to be like, how are you? And I felt that was just the most amazing thing. I was like, I'm fine, actually.
Yeah.
That's great. Yeah. So I just feel that once you've been in that realm or worked with people or sort of seen it, it's, you can't go back. I can't go back now.
You do it because you really believe in it. And,
yeah.
And like you said, Gemma, you make those connections with people and you see them go from the start of this kind of this journey where they're in a very difficult situation, hopefully see them through to the end of it. And there's just so much sort of injustice in the world. Generally, you really want to be part of something that can enact positive change. And I think that's why people stick with it.
You both are a true inspiration. Thank you so much for coming out in the cold and the wind and the rain. It's getting worse, isn't it? It really is getting worse.
Yeah.
It's coming in this way.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Well, we're still wanting you to donate. So, if you're still waiting and you want to press that button, it's so easy. Go to our website at www.glassdoor.org.uk/donate. And now let's hear a message from the comedian Tiff Stevenson.
Hi, everyone at the Glassdoor Sleep Out. I'm Tiff Stevenson. I'm so sorry I can't be with you tonight, but I just wanted to say what you're doing is amazing. Keep it up. I think if this pandemic has made anything clear, it's that having a home is a human right. Everyone deserves a safe place to live, no exceptions. And what Glassdoor are doing is providing that, offering support and emergency shelter and accommodation to anyone. No one is turned away. And I know sometimes it can be hard to confront homelessness. We have to engage in a level of cognitive dissonance, I suppose, to live our lives, to think I might help one person, but can I help them all? I was in America recently, in downtown Los Angeles, on the infamous Skid Row, where on one side of the street there are homeless people and on the other, self-storage units. And that struck me that we have a sickness in our society, that crap that people don't even want in their house gets to have shelter and a place to live, but human beings don't. How do we stop that? How do we change it? How do we make things better? And you guys are there doing it, trying to make things better. So good luck. Keep it up. And to anyone else watching who's not taking part, please do donate. I will be donating. The work that Glassdoor do is so, so important. Thank you so much.
With me now is Nadia Mischanka. Now, Nadia is going to, well, she's a wellness coach, aren't you? And a yoga teacher. And she's we're going to do is a wonderful, relaxing rise and shine yoga at 6:30 tomorrow morning for all you guys who are sleeping out tonight. Nadia, thank you for joining us. So tell me a little bit about what you're going to be doing.
With the yoga? Yeah. Or with the glass door? I will be doing just very relaxing yoga session, but it's not really relaxing. It's my third sleep out, and after the sleep out at night, you feel a little stiff. Like your neck gets a bit stiff, the lower back, and in general, all the joints get slightly impacted by the rough night. Mm. So this year, Melissa offered to do a yoga session, and I thought it's an amazing idea, and I was very happy to do it.
So the last 3 years, you have been sleeping out.
Yeah.
You were sleeping out. So you know what it feels like to sleep.
Yes,
on a hard surface throughout the whole night.
It's pretty intense, but yeah. I've been super lucky with the sleeping gear. And I think in a sleep out, it's the key. If you want to have a good sleep out, to have a good sleeping bag. And to get a mat placed underneath, so like today it's going to be wet, to get a little bit of a... But homeless people don't have this luxury.
Yes.
I guess with the glass door and other charities, we're trying to help them in a way to get a better sleep. I think some people are donating sleeping bags. I'm sure there are companies donating waterproof covers for the sleeping bags, but it's still... very rough to sleep out on a night like today. I'm doing the sleep out just for myself, and I will see how it goes, because I could see that the down of the sleeping bag would get kind of, the rain will cover it slightly.
And that's just for a single night?
It's a single night.
Single
so
night.
I think when it's every night, it is tough.
Yeah.
It gets you hard as nails. So when people make judgments on homeless people, I think they should imagine how it is to wake up every day feeling restless, and your mind is spinning, and you're trying to find the way out, maybe in the beginning, and you can't find the way out, and nobody's there to help. So we need Glassdoor and charities, yeah, and the government to really work with homeless people. And maybe there are some homeless people by choice, because I ask for donations all the time, and I get this constant dialogue that some people choose to be homeless. There are those who do, but I think a lot of the homeless people do not choose.
It's not a choice.
And they just forced on the street, and it's a big problem.
What motivated you, Nadia, to get involved in the first place into this area?
In general, I'm a yoga teacher, and the holistic and helping people, it feels right to me. It's in my nature. But then I was looking for something which is more of a doing. And in yoga, we believe in karma yoga. So it could be any fruits of labor which you can donate to someone without asking for anything in return. So I felt like if I maybe do the sleep out, but then it ended up being more about fundraising. So I think my labor in this, in support of Glassdoor, is asking other people who I know for money. And I think it works.
Yeah, yeah.
I feel super happy to support Glassdoor, and I'm mega grateful to everyone who donates to Glassdoor through me. Thank you so, so much.
So, come 6 o'clock, you'll be waking yourself up, getting ready,
yes,
for everybody else.
I'm planning to wake up earlier. Actually, 6 o'clock is comfortable.
Okay.
The drill here is different. They wake you up, but when you kind of just fallen asleep, they wake you up at 5. And I think because you have to clear the square,
yeah,
normally
course,
by 6.
Course, yeah.
And I was like, homeless people can't actually stay lazy during the day, because if you're sleeping at the tube entrance, mm-hmm, or at the shop entrance, they will ask you to get up and go. So you can't even just,
yes,
laze in,
yes,
your sleeping bag until 9.
No.
You have to move.
Yeah.
This is so tough.
And that's pressure, isn't it? Not only do you have to sleep on the street, you have to get up very early and just then walk and spend your day and find somewhere else to sleep.
Exactly, and they can't go to sleep earlier. They have to go to sleep after midnight when kind of their shops are closed or wherever they sleep.
That's tough.
So they sleep late and wake up early, and all day they're on the move. It's very tough.
Well, I think we're all going to be looking forward to your session, Nadia. And so hopefully we'll be feeling sprightly and awake and welcoming in the weekend.
I just hope so. And I hope everybody tomorrow eats well, drinks plenty of water, moves all day. Don't go back to bed and sleep all day. Just try to move and shake it all.
Yeah. Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you. It was so much fun.
Well, now we've got a real treat for you. We're going to be hearing the choir of St. Luke's Church.
When I needed a neighbor, were you there? When I needed a neighbor, were you there? And the creed and the colour and the name won't matter, were you there? I was hungry and thirsty, were you there?
Gosh, that was beautiful, wasn't it? Now, I've got my hat on now. It's getting that bad out there. I mean, it's really coming down. But we've got a Zoom call now. How exciting. From two young men. I think they're coming on now. And there they are. Hi.
Right.
Hello. Who
hello.
Am I speaking to?
Hello. Hello. Hi.
Can you actually introduce yourselves? Would you like to introduce yourselves? Oh, we lost them.
Yes, hi.
Oh, no, they're back.
My name's Callum. And
I'm Ed.
And together we
we run a social enterprise called The Good Slice.
Okay.
And we make pizza. We make pizza with a purpose. So we're actually partnered with Glassdoor Homeless Charity, and we've been partnered with them for about 2 years now.
Yeah.
And yeah, for every pizza we sell, we provide a hot meal to a shelter guest at Glassdoor shelters across the winter period.
So pizza with purpose. I like the sound of that. That sounds great. So where are you guys sleeping out tonight?
We're the only way I can hear you is by putting the microphone very close to my ear. But we are in Hammersmith. We're actually staying at my mum's house on her patio. And it's a little bit damp. Ed's fashioned the roof, which is sort of a couple of makeshift umbrellas. So the next time we do the sleep, I think I'll make the roof. He's also brought the sleeping bags. I hope they're waterproof.
Mine is.
Well,
Ed's is waterproof.
I wouldn't bank on it. It's pretty rainy here if it's anywhere near like we are. Thank you so much, guys. Keep well and try and stay dry. And yeah, thank you so much for all your efforts. It's really, really appreciated. So now in the studio, I've got Anna. Now, Anna is another caseworker, and Anna is a little bit special because she works with women particularly, don't you, Anna?
I do.
Yeah. And in what way do you work with the women?
I coordinate Glassdoor's women's group.
Yeah.
It's a weekly drop-in for homeless and vulnerably housed women. We run it as a co-productive space that's trauma and gender informed. We aim to model safe, positive professional working relationships with our female guests.
And what do you find is the common theme that keeps coming up over and over again? The themes.
Many women are barred from other services because many services don't necessarily employ a trauma and gender-informed approach to supporting women. Glassdoor's open access, the fact that it's a co-productive open space, means women are welcome. They're also, their engagement is based on choice. So when they come into our women's group, they don't necessarily have to give their name, they don't have to give any details. They can come and have a hot meal, use the washing facilities, the showers, maybe potentially engage in some arts and crafts activity, but ultimately engagement is in regards to resolving their kind of homelessness or housing situation. It's down to them, and by nurturing and kind of sustaining these relationships, we understand that women begin to open up, and once they feel that they are trusted and heard, then we can really start making progress on their situations. But women face very different challenges to men in regards to homelessness.
Yes.
Violence, domestic abuse, substance misuse, mental ill health, immigration issues all add to the complexities that women face who are homeless. And ultimately resolving that is dealing with all those kind of complex situations. Housing First, for example, is an excellent model that really deals with kind of the multiple disadvantages that women face. It bases their recovery process on a kind of multi-agency approach, really understanding that the relationships between all those support agencies need to be coordinated to really support and help the women. It understands that ultimately women need to start from a safe and stable position to be able to address all the kind of complex issues that they face, and ultimately also really puts them centre to their own recovery. It encourages empowerment and engagement with those services on a kind of more equal footing.
Yeah, we've talked about that. It's come up a few times, hasn't it, this evening, the idea of safety being really important in terms of sleep and now in terms of moving forward. And it sounds to me like it's so important to have a separate women's initiative.
Absolutely, definitely. Yeah. A lot of homelessness services are designed through a very kind of male-focused lens. It just doesn't take, they don't take into account the kind of complex issues and the multiple disadvantages that women face. Ultimately, we need to have more services that employ a kind of trauma and gendered-informed approach to resolving their situations.
And were you saying that's one of the main things that gets women leaving their homes and coming off the streets? mm-hmm. violence. Is violence a major factor?
It is. Alongside, it's complex. Often women present with these kind of multiple issues. Immigration matters, unresolved immigration matters is a huge issue. The current hostile immigration system really alienates and victimises and criminalises migrant women, for example. And we have women who attend our women's group and who attend our kind of destitution services and come into our night shelters with complex needs and varying kind of presenting issues. But ultimately, what needs to resolve it, what you need is a kind of more comprehensive partnership approach.
Which Glassdoor
does. Yeah.
And are they quite unique in that, do you think? Are they in the way they work and where you work?
I think we understand the importance of relationship building in our casework. But the fact we're open access means, again, that people can choose to engage.
Yeah.
And once those kind of trusting relationships are built, we can really make progress with addressing people's homelessness.
It's so important, isn't it, that people can just... One of those days, they just think, I'm just going to walk through that door.
Yes.
And they may walk past it for many days, many weeks, many months. And just one day, they go, I'm just going to walk through that door without any questions being asked.
Exactly.
No one asked my name or my history. They're just going to welcome me in.
We know that women, it can take up to, on average, it can take up to 36 contacts with various support services before they do engage with services around domestic violence. And that's women who may already be accommodated in the house. Mm. So if you take into account all the women who are homeless or rough sleeping, vulnerably housed, who have all these other issues, how many contacts with agencies they will have before, you know, any progress can be made.
Gosh.
And we acknowledge that, and we recognise that it's small steps, but developing that trusting relationship, keeping that door open to them so they can come back whenever they need to ask for help. We'll be here, we're available, and we'll do our best to help them.
And why do you do this work, Anna? What is it that drives you?
I'm passionate about the work. I'm passionate about the fact that people can be let down by services and excluded from services when they need to be heard, they need to be seen. And Glassdoor is brilliant for that because we see and we hear the women who come through our doors.
So important.
It is.
Thank you so much. You know, struggling out of the wind and the rain, and I know, you know, it's something that's very close to your heart. I can see that. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we've now got another little film for you. Off to cinema.
You've got people
camping out tonight in your church. How many have you got?
So we've got 12 of us here tonight, plus a guard dog. So we're feeling quite secure.
Yeah.
But yeah, we're excited.
And what's the plan for the evening?
Well, at the moment we've got some Monopoly on the go, and I think just to sort of settle down and have chats and spend some time together.
Have you ever done this sort of thing before?
I haven't, because this is my first time here, but I know that there are lots of people in the parish and in the congregation that have done this several times before. So I'm the novice here, and people are leading me in it.
And do you think it's really important for the community to get involved in things like this?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think especially because, you know, in this community, we walk past people that are sleeping on the streets and sleeping rough all the time. So I think we can often feel paralysed and helpless in knowing what to do about a problem that seems so impossible to solve. So things like this are really good because they're just small steps that help make a small difference in part of a wider chain. So.
And I suppose it makes people feel like they can have an influence somehow, or actually do an action that will actually lead to some good, rather than just feeling paralysed by what could I do because the problem's so huge.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely right. I think, you know, most people, when they see this issue of homelessness, they're desperate to do something about it. And I think it's exactly right that it's that sort of what can I do?
Mm.
And so this is really great because it gives some people a sort of small thing that they can do, a small little thing that just sort of slowly changes the flavour and the atmosphere in the local community that says, this is an issue that we care about, we don't want to ignore it, and we want to do as much as we can, bit by bit.
Well, I hope you have a good night's sleep.
Well, we'll see, but thank you.
I'll let you get back to your Monopoly.
Cheers, thank you.
And to donate now. If you still haven't donated and you want to, then please do. Just go to glassdoor.org.uk/donate and just press the button. Remember, every penny counts, so please do dig deep if you possibly can. And coming up, the lineup is still there. And what else have we got coming up for you? Well, we've got Jim Carter. He's going to read us a bedtime story. We're going to have DJ Northern Boy. And of course, we've got the 6:30 yoga with Nadia. And if you're very good and you pledge lots and lots of money, and I smile at the producer, she might play Colin Firth reading the poem again. So come on, dig deep, and let's get Colin back on the screen. So, now we're going to meet a couple of very special people, Neil and Joe, another two caseworkers. Oh, actually, they're coming now. They're actually coming into the studio, so we're going to meet them in person, which is even better. Welcome. Come in. Now, that's a great hat. Better than, I can't say better than mine, but hello.
Nice
on another
you.
Great hat, would you gentlemen like to introduce yourselves?
I'm Joe, I'm Joe Tucker, Joe casewalker.
And I'm Neil,
welcome.
I'm also one of the caseworkers.
So, Joe and Neil, you both are caseworkers, aren't you, at Glassdoor. So tell me, what do you do?
So I'm one of the heads of casework at Glassdoor. So kind of what we do as a casework service is try and support our guests that come to us through our night shelters or into our partner drop-ins to move on out of homelessness or to maintain their housing if they're at risk of losing it. But there are kind of a whole range of different things which will come into that. Not just helping people with accommodation, we support people around benefit claims, around finding employment, replacing lost ID, establishing their eligibility, particularly at the moment if they're European nationals through the EU settlement scheme, and kind of lots of other things. We kind of try and act as a one-stop shop for what our guests need.
It's complicated, isn't it? Yeah. So, I mean, I guess for you, Joe, it's every case is different. We've just been speaking about it.
Yeah,
I mean,
absolutely. Every case is different. I mean, it's just so you almost cannot say this is what we do only, you know, because it can be anything. You can have guests that come to you. Probably they have a dispute with a telephone company or not a business, you know, whether be it a claim that they want to put in or they want to dispute a claim. So you end up doing almost everything.
And I think that also kind of, whilst our focus is on trying to move people out of homelessness, one thing is important is to build trust with guests.
Yes.
So I think if we try and be too regimented about what we will do and what we won't do, sometimes kind of if we want to dive straight into kind of what their housing history is or what their kind of most serious difficulties are, that might be something that some guests are not ready to discuss when they've met you for the first time. And actually, if you do help them with some of what we might see as the smaller things first, that helps them to see that you're someone who is going to listen to what's important to them. And kind of show that you can achieve things.
It is all about building that relationship, isn't it, and building that trust. So it is baby steps, isn't it?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, you see some guests, when you encounter them for the first time, they might think, well, I've just come basically for benefit, you know, to help for benefit claim or something. But then, as you get along with them, as they build up that trust, then you realize they tell you, oh, you know what, I had this alcohol problem, or I had this drug problem, or I had this other issue. you know, then they just open up like a flower, you know.
That must be really satisfying. And can you share with us some stories without going into too much detail, not any names or anything, but just some examples of when it has worked, when you've seen somebody from the beginning and gone all the way through?
Yeah, I mean, I think kind of there's an irony that when it works best, we don't get to know someone very well, because kind of things can be sorted out very quickly if someone has eligibility and we can kind of link them in with a housing provider. But the people we do get to know best, sadly, are sometimes the most complex cases because they take the longest to resolve. And I think the ones that are kind of perhaps the most satisfying are when you have known someone kind of for some cases many years, when we've known them. You know, I can think of a couple of cases of people with very serious alcohol problems who might not have had eligibility at that stage for housing, but also that meant they also didn't have eligibility for alcohol rehab. And we've seen those people kind of be in such bad states that we were having to kind of say they couldn't come into our night shelters, but we were still trying to work with them as best we could, meeting their basic needs, and trying to support them to try and get treatment. And we've managed to then, for example, recently with the EU settlement scheme, which we've got trained caseworkers who are able to support guests, yes, to make those applications, establish their eligibility, because they've been in the country for 10 years in some cases and have had periods of work and then periods of when they've kind of not been in work, often because of the alcohol kind of problems that they've had. And establishing that eligibility, yeah, has been a real game changer.
So it's interesting, isn't it, how you sort of sort one problem out and then suddenly everything else becomes a lot yeah, simpler and much more straightforward. Joe, why did you get involved in this work in the first place?
Well, for me, it's actually... I know it sounds almost like a cliché, but it's like a personal calling, because my life journey has not been the easiest. Obviously, everyone's life journey is unique to them. But coming from war torn Sierra Leone as a refugee, young adult, having to leave my country all by myself without my parents or family, and you know, all the tribulations, the trials that I've been through. Being refugee in different foreign countries, in Guinea-Conakry, Ivory Coast, Ghana, the Netherlands, and then finally ending up here. So for me, it's really something I have to give back, because in all that time that I was going through all those difficulties, those trials, forget about whatever I went through, being internally displaced in my country for several years, yeah, before I finally got out. And
so you've got a real appreciation of what it feels like to,
yeah,
be...
Yeah, but, you know, when you go through certain things in life, then you learn to appreciate the little things, yeah, in life, you know, the things that really matter.
Yeah.
You know, the things that really matter, like... I'll tell you, when I was in Holland, one of the things that really mattered to me that I heard from a church member, it was just a quote. I didn't know it was from an anonymous author that says, one day at a time, this is enough. Do not look back and grieve about, yeah, the past, for it is gone. Do not be troubled about the future, yeah, for it has not yet come. Live in the present and make it so beautiful, yeah, it will be worth remembering. I was like, and this was a Dutch person saying this to me in English. I was like, okay, well, whatever. But I tried to digest,
that
you know.
Kind of sticks with you.
So it's so little, it's non-material. Mm. It's just non-material thing. It's nothing, it's just anything anyone could have said to me on the street. But she said those words to me, and I kept on like digesting them, chewing them, regurgitating, if you like, over the years. And we're talking over 20 years ago, and I still know exactly those words. It's like I heard them yesterday. So, but saying that, also I've met amazing people, you know, I've encountered people, strangers, total strangers, that have just given me an apple or just a banana
it's
or
amazing,
something.
It's amazing, isn't it? Like how interaction with people, somebody gives you something and it just puts you on a different path.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and then
wonderful.
It just makes you realise, wow. You know, despite the degradation that you do get, like,
yeah,
I'm gonna say that, you know, you're a refugee or whatever. There was a time in Holland that I realized this guy was following me so much in the supermarket, the security guard.
I even
asked him, like, can you help me carry my grocery basket? You know, because
right. Yeah,
it's taking me to pinch something or whatever.
Yeah,
but,
fantastic.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, you two, for speaking to us. It's been wonderful to have you. Thank you very much. So let's take a look at something, a homeless person that Glassdoor has helped. Preconception that people who end up in our situation are involved in drink or drugs. I thought this too before I went to the night shelter. Then I realised, wow, they're people. We're people. What is so wonderful about the staff and volunteers is the hope they manage to engender in us. And now, we're going to go for a little view of Peter Jones on a roof, I think. He and his staff are camping out somewhere in London. John
on
Lewis.
The roof of Peter Jones department store, branch of John Lewis, by the way, in Sloane Square. And we are sleeping out on behalf of Glassdoor, a homeless charity, which is just down the road from us in King's Road. And there's five of us sleeping out on the roof of Peter Jones as part of the Sleep Out, Sleep In fundraiser for that charity. I think the majority of people that are doing it are actually choosing to sleep in some way, but, you know, we're doing it, we're sleeping out. We've made a bit of a bivouac for ourselves on the roof and with some plastic, and that's where we are.
We were sort of just reaching out to friends and family, colleagues at work. Everyone's always quite supportive at work, and we sort of posted on our social pages within our shop. I think we've raised over £1,500 now, haven't we?
Yeah.
Our target originally was set at £500, and we thought, oh, that's going to be a challenge.
We've raised that in under 2 weeks.
Yeah. Which is quite a feat, really. Yeah. We're really pleased with how much we've raised.
You know, whatever's happening in the world, in the country, whatever's happening is going to be 10 times much worse if you haven't got a roof over your head. Also, this branch, this store, our company, does a lot of charitable work, and the Glassdoor charity that we're raising funds for is one that we are engaged with, with anyway. So that brings in that particular engagement. On a personal basis, my brother, sadly no longer with us, was homeless for a very long time, drug problems, living on the streets, and a homeless shelter really turned his life around. Not enough to save him, unfortunately, but enough to make the latter days of his life much, much better and more comfortable. And so I have a personal reason for doing it as well.
The pandemic has also really highlighted those that are in need and those that are vulnerable. I think the great work that sort of hotels and whatnot did to sort of bring the homeless in during those times, sort of as everything opened up, sort of all stopped, and then you know what happens after then. And I think it's so important to raise awareness and raise, you know, as much money as we can, but just really to raise awareness about the charities and the good things that they do, so local to us here and within London and the rest of the country.
So if you'd like to support this charity and this cause and this Sleep Out, you can go to the Glassdoor charity website and donate directly to them. There is also our offshoot page, which is Peter Jones, which I'm not sure if you can link to from the main donation.
Yeah, you can.
You can. I'm getting a thumbs
Peter
up.
Jones.
You can. So you can donate through us as a secondary, on a secondary page, or direct to Glassdoor. Either way.
It all goes there.
It all goes there, and you know we are, as a whole, like movement tonight, raising an awful lot of money, and the money is going to be spent for the winter shelters that Glassdoor are going to provide for the homeless.
Look at them all, isn't that brilliant? All six of them up on top of Peter Jones just across the road here, getting wet like the rest of us. And, you know, that group of people have already raised over £1,500. I mean, that's just incredible. Well done. I mean, that's just so impressive, really brilliant. And with me now is Lucy, CEO of Glassdoor.
Hi, Elizabeth.
How are you? Looking very resplendent in purple.
Thank you.
I'm in the red,
purple.
You're in the purple.
Yeah,
we've got
we're
like
a
the whole
combo,
wardrobe going, haven't we? It's back on with the hat, isn't it?
I know, it's getting really, really
it
cold
is getting,
now.
Isn't it?
And wet feet.
Wet and kind of wild out here tonight.
Yeah.
Really
yeah.
wild out here.
Someone said to me today, I think it's the worst day of weather of the entire year. I think they're right.
Yeah, you chose a good night to do this, didn't
That's
you?
That, yeah.
But you know, in a way, as we said before, this is exactly when we should be doing it, because
yeah.
we need to
yeah.
see how awful it is when it's at its worst, actually,
exactly.
and what it might be like sleeping out on this.
Exactly, what life's really like.
Yeah.
And we always say, actually, in the winter with our shelters, the wet days can be some of the worst, because actually, once someone's completely soaked through, it's so hard to get warm again. It's,
yeah. And so what is going to be happening over the winter months?
So, ordinarily, we would be running our night shelters in churches. Many people watching will know there's normally 5 shelters running across West London every night of winter. Government guidance currently is that because of shared airspace and the risk of the spread of COVID, shelters aren't able to run in their normal way. So we're awaiting further guidance as to in what circumstances shelters would be able to operate. But in the meantime, it's been a good opportunity for us to really think about, well, how else can we support our guests? So we've been looking at COVID-safe types of emergency accommodation, and we are hoping to be able to provide hostels with single rooms that will allow guests to not only have somewhere to sleep in a bed 24/7, somewhere that's COVID safe because everyone will be in their own room, but also we'll be able to have our caseworkers on site to help people to really take that path out of homelessness as quickly as possible. So that's you know, a really great opportunity for people that turn to us this winter. And then obviously we've still got our wonderful church spaces. We've got all our brilliant volunteers who are really keen to support still. And we're going to be providing dinner. So in all the boroughs that we currently work in, which is Kensington and Chelsea, Hammersmith and Fulham, Wandsworth and Richmond, we'll be running a dinner service. Again, it will have to be adapted, very different with COVID, much smaller capacity, smaller number of volunteers, lots of precautions in place. But it does mean that guests will be able to come, get out of the cold and
yeah.
the rain, have a good meal, have that really important human company, have, you know, conversation and community.
Yes, we've not talked about that a huge amount, but actually the companionship and the community is so key, isn't it?
Exactly. And that's, you know, that's really what our guests tell us when we get feedback from all the guests at the end of the season. And what they tell us time and time again is it's the volunteers, the love that's shown to them, the compassion, the conversation, someone asking about your day, and you know, that element. And it's especially during COVID with lockdown and everybody needing to be much more you know, isolated, it's really important to still have that kind of community feeling. So that's, you know, why we think the dinner service element will be really important.
So the idea is that they can go to certain places and get their dinner, and then they can hopefully go to a hostel. Is that the idea?
Well, no, actually, there'll be 3 courses provided at the hostels.
Okay.
So people that are staying in our hostels will have, yeah, 3 meals a day served to their room. And snacks in between, and then the dinner service will be for people who have not been able to stay in the hostel. We'll run a waiting list, as we always do with the night shelters, so as soon as we can move people in, as soon as somebody moves into a permanent home, then we'll be able to move someone else in. But we should have capacity for around about 88 people to stay in their own room accommodation.
I guess it's been quite a juggling act for you, and shifting all the time and just waiting to see what you can and can't do.
Exactly, yeah. It's been a really tough few months for everybody, I think. We've had to be really responsive. The whole staff team have been absolutely incredible. I know you've spoken to some
yeah.
of our caseworkers earlier this evening, and you know, they've all felt so passionately that actually now more than ever, during a crisis like this, our guests need us. And that's when, you know, obviously with all the right precautions in place again, and, you know, being really careful about how it's done, that we need to be there for our guests. And actually, in many ways, over the last few months, you know, there have been opportunities presented. So our guests that were staying in the hotels that were moved into the hotels by the government, you know, the caseworkers have been able to keep up a really good relationship with them and help many more people into housing.
It's been a challenging time all around, hasn't it? And for everyone watching tonight, what would you like to say? And into, if they're thinking of donating and they're just not sure whether to press that button, what can you say to them to make them decide just to do it?
I think it's just realising the transformation that it makes to people's lives. That you know, a small donation, no matter how small or big, can just transform people's lives. I know, again, we've seen Eddie and James earlier in the night, and talking to you know. Understanding the stories of how just something really small can completely be devastating for people, and actually by donating that is allowing someone, and by sleeping out for one night in this terrible weather, it's allowing somebody else to have a roof over their head for the winter and beyond.
And what people forget is that when you do that, you feel better.
Yeah. Exactly.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So come on, everybody. Let's do another call out for some more donations. So if you haven't donated yet, you haven't run out of time, there's still plenty of time to keep donating. Just go to our website, glassdoor.org.uk/donate. And now, earlier in the evening, I was over at St Luke's Church interviewing a quite remarkable woman called Sarah and her beautiful dog. And not only is she sleeping out tonight, she's doing something amazing tomorrow. I'll let her tell you more. I'm with Sarah Pearson, who is one of the people taking part in tonight's sleep out, or sleep in, aren't you, Sarah?
Yes.
And who's this? Who's this with
this
you?
This is Annie.
Annie, she's beautiful.
Thank you.
So tell me a little bit about what you're doing and why you're doing it.
Well, it all stems from the fact that, I've always, myself and my company have always supported Glassdoor, but I do think this year in particular, I feel very strongly we were very lucky when COVID struck. I feel it's rather like a giant game of musical chairs, and the music stopped and we got lucky because of the business we did and the clients we had. It hasn't really affected us. So I felt very strongly that we should do something in return. So we think we've raised about £10,000, and we've been heavily involved in helping Glassdoor with the social side and the PR side, and taking part. I've got about 10 people sleeping in the office because they can't be outside either. So, but I've come here because I'm going on the marathon walk tomorrow.
With Annie?
Yes.
With Annie. So she's sleeping. Which is your bed? This is your bed?
Yes.
Just here?
26 miles in the pouring rain tomorrow.
Oh. Which, my goodness me.
Seemed like a great idea when the weather was nice, but I'm sure it'll be fine. But,
and where are you walking?
From Chelsea to Richmond and back.
And back?
Yes.
So have you got any stops on the way?
Yes, two.
Okay. So. And she's going to be okay, Annie, is she?
She's done very long walks before, so yeah. So she's, well, I hope so.
And she's a rescue.
She's got four legs, I've only got two. She's younger than me too.
And she's a rescue as well, isn't she?
Yeah, she was found in a ditch in Greece, so she's quite a hardy creature.
So she was homeless?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
So she knows what she's doing it for.
Exactly, exactly. So what's the plan for this evening? It looks like you've got some games, and there's going to be maybe bit of pizza eaten and then
yes,
keeping down.
I'm trying to sleep. I've done it once before, and I've done it outside, and I don't think much sleep was had, just simply because it's sort of a bit foreign to be here. But I hope to get some rest because we're up and away at 6 tomorrow. So, you know, we need a bit of a break.
Well, I think it's an extraordinary thing you're doing. Thank you so much.
Anyway, well, thank you so much for taking the time to film us. Thank you.
What an inspirational lady. I mean, I just hope the weather's a bit better tomorrow so she doesn't have to walk a whole marathon in this, and her poor dog's going to get so wet as well. So fingers crossed it improves tomorrow morning. Now we're going to see a quote from the people who actually own the square we're sitting in. Cadogan, they own the square, and every year they let us do the sleep house. And this, they say, this year, with restrictions on people congregating, the event is necessarily taking a virtual form in the shape of a sleep-in. We hope that everyone takes to their back gardens and kitchen floors to join in and support Glassdoor in their vital mission to provide shelter for those sleeping rough across South and West London this winter, and make 2020 the most memorable event to date. And they're saying they want to see us back here at the Duke of York Square. In the meantime, stay safe, warm and dry. Thank you so much. Now, please remember, we're all here today. Please try and convince you to support this wonderful cause. Glassdoor is really an amazing charity. What they do is so fundamental to so many people, and it's so easy to donate. So please do go to our website, glassdoor.org.uk/donate, and just press the button. So now, treat we've all been waiting for. You may have missed this earlier in the evening. We're going to bring it back just for you because you've been doing such a great job of donating. It's Colin Firth reading a beautiful poem. Sit back and relax.
Hello. I'm reading this in support of Glassdoor, a charity who support people in need of shelter and who support people in the move beyond homelessness. This is also for everybody participating in the Sleep Out. It's a poem called Homeless Man by C.J. Heck. Homeless man, I watched you lie in a deserted doorway. Your Maytag boxes, cardboard monuments in FedEx labels and signs pointing this side up. Stark reminders of what is. And what could be, but for the grace of God. I wondered if I wished hard enough, a FedEx truck might spirit you away on a magic carpet ride to where you wouldn't be invisible, for those who take the time to look and really see. To where someone would offer you a job with no catch 22, first telling you to shower and having clean clothes, and you with no money for either without a job. I wished, I prayed, but for the grace of God go I.
Oh, wasn't that lovely? Thank you so much, Colin. He's been a great supporter of the charity for a while now. So yes, wonderful to hear him speak those wonderful, wonderful words. Okay, so now we've got a short film with some fantastic gentlemen, Ben and Steve. I spoke to them earlier. They are both shelter managers here at Glassdoor.
I'm here with Steve Gamble and Ben Davis, two long-standing shelter managers at Glassdoor. Ben, can you tell me what it's like, a typical night in a shelter?
It's, imagine sort of 40 people in a very enclosed space living together. We starts about 6:30 in the evening. We'll get a group of volunteers. Glassdoor basically runs on volunteers, which is what this evening is all about. So we'll have a group of volunteers who will be cooking for about 35 to 45 rough sleepers. So the managers will come in, check the venue over for health and safety. That takes about 20 minutes. It'll probably take a lot longer now under COVID and so forth. We'll get people in around 8:30 and get them fed. It'll be a typical meal. Three courses, soup, main meal, and then a very nice dessert. We'll try and get people down for sort of about 9:30, 10 o'clock. The manager is there to make sure things run smoothly, make sure that there are no difficulties with difficult guests and so forth. We do, most of the people here are very, very easy. They want to get themselves down to sleep as quickly as possible, but occasionally there is difficulties, and so we're there to make sure that things run as smoothly as possible.
And for people who don't know what a shelter looks like, can you sort of describe it a bit, and what do the guests actually
Me and Steve will be coming in with our vans. We basically have an entire night shelter in a van. So we'll have 35 yoga mats that we can roll out on the floor. We'll have tea, coffee, changes of clothes, a basic first aid kit, toolbox for every eventuality kind of thing. But they'll come in. they'll start arriving at about 7 o'clock in the evening to about 5 to 8. So we have to do a check to make sure that they're okay, whether they're healthy, whether they've got symptomatic of COVID, whether they've had alcohol and so forth, and we make a judgment call. Some of us are harder on the guests than others. Steve,
you're looking at me now.
Yeah, it's true. Steve's a lot more hardcore than I am. But you know, we try and keep as many people. We want people to arrive. We want people to have a good time. We want people to be safe. We also have a duty of care to our volunteers. We, as I said earlier, we run on volunteers. It doesn't work without the generosity of parishioners and people from the surrounding area. You know, from Chelsea, Wandsworth, places like that. So we'll be gathering people in. The area will probably be about the size of about 2 tennis courts. So we'll have 30 men, probably 5 to 10 women in separate areas around the building. So we'll try and get them to sleep as quickly as possible. They will have been on the streets and, you know, up and at them. The previous night shelter would have finished at 7 o'clock in the morning. So on a day like today, especially when there's nothing open, these guys will be cold, tired, wet, bad-tempered. We tend to think of the homeless people as a kind of homogenous mass, but they're 30 to 35 individuals with their own stories and with their own problems.
And do you find that they come back time and time again?
Yes, unfortunately. You know, what we would like, you know, at the end of the season, me and Steve will always say to somebody, I don't want to ever see you again. Because, you know, hopefully they'll get themselves into accommodation. Our accommodation team are absolutely brilliant at placing people. But yeah, unfortunately there are... Yeah, I've not been doing the night shelter for 2 years, you know, full time, but I can sort of say, I can guess probably there'll be half a dozen people who I'll see back and go, oh, still here again. But there we are.
And Steve, how many years have you been a shelter manager?
I think, if I'm back again this year, it'll probably be my 12th year. Yeah.
Wow, yeah. 12 yeah. years. And what is the atmosphere like? What's the mood like in the shelter?
The atmosphere is it's excellent, actually. Most of the time, the atmosphere is really good. It's a jovial atmosphere. People are very happy to be inside rather than out on the street in a wet night like this. And the atmosphere is twofold. It's also the interaction between the guests and our volunteers. So it's usually a very good vibe between the two. It can sometimes be a bit fractious, but that's very rare. Most of the time, it's a very good atmosphere. People are just happy to be able to come in, have a nice hot meal, nice three-course meal, sit down, have a chat with friends that you might not have seen throughout the day, have a good chat, catch up with them, and have, like I said, a good interaction with the volunteers. Our volunteers are absolutely superb. Without them, it just wouldn't be the same.
And a night like this, I mean, it just shows how important a shelter is. I mean, yeah. You know, the likes of you and me have got the option of going back to our homes.
We can go back to our bed. At 10 o'clock, I'll finish my shift and go back to my own bed. Unfortunately, the people we have haven't got that luxury.
And what is it, gentlemen, that keeps you coming back year after year?
Year after year? I look forward to the first week in November, because it's like going somewhere and being introduced to a new family. Yeah. And that's what it's like throughout the whole season. It becomes your family. Yeah. And you look after them, you care for them for the 5 months of the year. And like I said, and as Ben said, you hope at the end of the season that you don't see them again. But you always see one or two.
One or two, they're always back. Yeah.
And it's catching up again.
Yeah, what Steve
is,
said.
It's like one big family. It is a family.
Yeah. It's just, having done this, I came... 9 years ago as a temp. I was going to do one season, and you know, these people are now my extended family. These are the people who I look forward to coming back. You know, we do a lot of us do lots of different work during the summer. I go off and work for a company called St Mungo's. Steve works for a great place called the Ace of Clubs. But we all, you know, come October, November time, we'll be phoning each other up. What's going on this year? What's going on? Who's going to be back? Who's going to be working with whom and stuff like that. It's just, and the ethos of the place is so good. I do management work for the 6 months a year. I'm a pen pusher. Coming back here, this is the cutting edge. What makes Glassdoor unique is that we work with everybody. Most night shelters will have a criteria of who can come in and who can't come in. We work with absolutely everyone. We don't turn people away.
Open door policy. We do work with everybody. We love to work with everybody, and like I said, there's lots, just like me and Ben, who come back year after year after year. There's a few. I think
we're comparatively new. I mean, there are a couple of guys who have been working for the thing since, you know, the late 1990s. So, you know, there are people who have come back.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, Bruce, God knows how old Bruce is these days.
About
105. Yeah, about 105. One of the night shelter managers, you know, was grey-haired when I turned up 9 years ago. He's white-haired now. He's like a very jovial Canadian Santa Claus. And he comes back year after year after year. And, we're not here for the money particularly. We're here because...
We care.
It's a really easy way to help people, and that's what could be better than that?
One volunteer who's been doing it for 21 years now.
Yeah,
right from the very start, she's been volunteering, and she'll be back again this year to do something.
Of the 25 people who will be coming tonight, I bet you she's one of the people. She'll be here. Yeah.
What's her name?
Rosie.
Right.
Yes, we both knew. Yeah, Rosie, MBE or OBE.
I don't know. Yeah, I'm not sure if she's in
granddaughter of something. Yeah, Rosie's one of those people who will turn up. What can I do? How can I help? How can we make this calm? How can we make this better?
And she volunteers in at least three different shelters.
Yeah, yeah.
So, gentlemen, this is going live to all sorts of people watching. Some are volunteering, some who are participating tonight. What would you say to them about?
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And on a night like tonight, you're very, very brave.
Yeah.
But the biggest thing is that every single penny that you manage to raise is worth everything. Yeah. Every single penny counts.
Yeah.
So the more you raise, the more we have.
We run a very lean ship here. Very, very tight.
Yeah.
It's not. It doesn't go on management and stuff like that. Mm. The money that you raise here directly funds the stuff that we work. The more awareness, the more money that we raise here, is the more people we can help. When I was started here 9 years ago, we had three shelter circuits. We've got five this year. We're looking to get open six.
There was one when I started.
Yeah, well, there you are. Yeah, you know, and it we've gone from a tiny organisation in a room not much bigger than this giant umbrella that we're under to, you know, a huge organisation. We are the largest single open access night shelter in the country, and we're very, very proud of that. But it doesn't work without the volunteers, and it doesn't work without the fundraisers.
We've done our bit of fundraising as well.
Yes, we cycled to Paris about four years. Is it really 4 years?
Just to celebrate my 60.
Oh God, you were 60 and I was the idiot who fell off on the second day. So there we are. Yeah.
Wonderful, gentlemen. Thank you so much. Have a good night.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
What total gents, really were so nice speaking to them. Now listen, if you still want to help, you want to do more than just donate tonight, please go to the website. There's all sorts of information there. So if you go to the Glassdoor website and you can click on how to help, and then you can go to frequently asked questions. And in that section, there's so much information that you can print out and use yourself. Or if you see somebody on the street who you think would benefit from that information, print it out and hand it to them. And of course, you can still donate on the website if you get the urge to do so. So please do dig deep. Okay, now we have a little film with Hannah. Hannah is sleeping out somewhere and hopefully not getting too wet.
Hi. My name's Hannah Stanislaus and I'm sleeping out for Glassdoor tonight. Just doing this as it's my first time and I feel a little bit like, woo. So yeah, and then I heard tonight there's a storm coming. So anyway, I have a choice whether I sleep out tonight, and many, many people don't. And I've just packed my bag as to what I'm taking to sleep out with. So just want to show. So I've got sleeping bag, got a bivy bag, I've got a change of clothes for the morning, and I've got a pillow. And you know, it's for some people that's all they've got, and one day I hope that nobody ever has to sleep out. And I have a 4.5-year-old little girl, and I want her to know that not everybody has a home like we do. And so I'm hoping that we can be the inspiration for change. Please, if you can, share and donate. And hopefully one day no one will have to sleep outdoors. Thank you.
People like that are truly inspiring, aren't they? They really, really are. And we've got some photos for you of people who are actually, there they are, sleeping out this evening on mats and sleeping bags. These are our people who are taking part in the sleep out this evening, doing sterling work, experiencing what it's like to be homeless for a night. And there's St Mary's Church, and raising money while they're doing so. Inspirational stuff, really. Now we have a real treat for you. Jim Carter, the well-known actor from Downton Abbey, is going to sit down and read us all a bedtime story, so get comfy.
Hello, my name is Jim Carter, and I'm going to read you a bedtime story. I'm doing this in support of Glassdoor, which is a wonderful charity that supports the homeless, people who have to sleep rough, which seems to me crazy that in a developed country like ours, people are still sleeping rough. But they're having, Glassdoor are holding a big sleep out to raise money, to raise awareness, to raise funds, to get people off the street, to offer them security and safety. I think this is a great cause. The book that I'm reading tonight is one that I used to read to my daughter when she was little. It's called Cuddly Dudley, and it's by written and illustrated by Jez Albra, and it's about a very cuddly little penguin, okay? There might be great messages in this book, but who can resist a book by a cuddly penguin? So, Cuddly Dudley by Jez Albra. I'll hold it round this way so you can see some of the pictures, and I'd like to say that behind the camera is Lucy Abraham, who's the chief executive officer of Glassdoor, and she's very nervous about handling the camera, so we'll do our best between us. Here we go, Cuddly Dudley. Dudley, love to play. I've forgotten something, amateur mistake. I need to put the specs on. Hold on, don't go to sleep yet. Here we go, that's better. Dudley loved to play. He loved jumping, diving, and splashing. But most of all, Dudley loved to play all by himself. Come and have a look at this, Lucy. There we go. There's Dudley playing all by himself. But I don't know if you can see up on the ice floe, there's trouble up there. Okay. The trouble was, Dudley was such a lovely, cuddly penguin that whenever his brothers and sisters found him on his own, they couldn't resist having a huddle and a waddle and a cuddle with him. "Go away," Dudley would say. "Leave me alone." "We can't," came the reply. "You're just too cuddly, Dudley." There they are, cuddling Dudley, who looks a little bit nonplussed. "I'm fed up with all your huddling and waddling and cuddling," said Dudley one day. "I'm going to find a place where I can play all on my own." And off he went. He waddled and he toddled for many, many miles until, quite by chance, he found a little wooden house which looked perfect for a penguin. And it seemed to be empty. I'll just draw your attention, Lucy, to this little teddy bear in the corner with shades on and a Hawaiian shirt. "At last," said Dudley, who by now, as you'll notice, Lucy, is wearing a Hawaiian shirt and the shades. "At last," said Dudley, "a house of my own, a place where I can jump about all day without being disturbed." Just then, there came a rap-tap-tap at the little wooden door. "It's us," said two of Dudley's sisters. "We followed your waddle prints. Can we come in?" "No, you jolly well can't," said Dudley. "I'm very busy and I don't want to be disturbed, so please go away." And he shut the little wooden door and was alone once more. "At last," said Dudley. You'll notice, Lucy, that he's filled the bath here. a house of my own, a place where I can splash about all day without being... Just then, there came a rap-tap-tap at the little wooden door. "It's us," said his brothers and sisters. "We followed your waddle prints. Can we come in?" "And no, you jolly well can't," said Dudley. "I don't want to huddle and waddle and cuddle. So for the very last time, stop following me around." He slammed the little wooden door and was alone once more. "At last," sighed Dudley, "a house of my own." Bang, bang, bang went the little wooden door. "That does it," he said. "When I catch those penguins, I'll..." But it wasn't a penguin at the little wooden door. It was a great big man. "My word," said the great big man. "What an adorable penguin! Give us a cuddle," he cried, and chased Dudley all round the house and out into the snow. Dudley ran and ran and escaped from the man. Then he decided to head back home. But which way was home? Crunch, crunch, crunch went Dudley, looking for some wattle prints to follow. But when night came, he was still alone and completely lost. And now, for the first time, he was lonely. He climbed a hill to get a better view. And at the top, he saw an enormous orange moon with hundreds of tiny sparkling stars huddled all around. "Excuse me," said a penguin from the foot of the hill. "Have you finished being alone yet? Only we wondered, now that you're back, if you wouldn't mind whether we could... It's just that you're so... You're so..." "Cuddly!" shouted Dudley, and he bounced down the hill as fast as he could. Then Dudley and all his brothers and sisters had the best huddling, waddling, cuddling session that they'd ever had. Until... "Give us a cuddle!" And that's the end of the story. Now, I hope you enjoyed that. I hope you can see some of the pictures. Well done, Lucy, on camera. And please, 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 do support Glassdoor. Support the Sleep Out. Go to glassdoor.org.uk and make a donation. Anything you can give would be greatly welcomed. It's a wonderful charity doing great work. And I can't thank you enough for watching. And I hope I haven't put you to sleep. Good night.
Wasn't that wonderful? Oh, so lovely. Thank you so much, Jim, for that. And please do what he said, and please donate. Every penny makes such a difference. Thank you so much. Well, now we're going to on a Zoom call to Belinda with Belinda and her dog, Freddie. Belinda, are you there? Yes, there she is. Hi, Belinda. Where are you? Where are you sleeping out?
I am. Hi.
Hi. Where are you?
We are actually sleeping out in West Sussex. We're in West Sussex this weekend, and we are sleeping out at our front door on our driveway.
Wow. And how's Freddie getting on?
Freddie's great. Freddie, as you can see, Freddie is doing really well. He is snoozing. He's in my sleeping bag. He's got a little waterproof pajama on. So he's nice and warm and cozy. And Freddie is 11, so I'm making sure that he's nice and warm.
Fantastic.
And this is his fourth year doing the sleep out. So he is a seasoned sleep out.
That's amazing.
Dog.
That's amazing. And how much have you raised so far, Belinda? Do you know?
We have raised about £1,400, and we're aiming to raise £2,000, and we will make our We will make the total. We will raise £2,000.
That's fantastic. That's really, oh, thank you so, so, so much. Brilliant. Well, have a good night. And if anybody else wants to donate, you know what to do. Go to the website, glassdoor.org.uk/donate, and press a button. And come on, let's treat ourselves and see how much we've raised so far. And here's the total as of now. It is £120,000. That is incredible, really. Please keep your donations coming in. The night is young. It's just been wonderful. And now we have such a treat for you. We're going to go live to DJ Northern Boy.
Enter in the dance, plug it in and we begin. Crowd up in the center, they watch with the rhythm. Watch the way we drop it in a mixed timing. Rise and amplifying when we come in with the twist. Just following the back and naturally harmonizing. Climb into position with synchronizing. Live from out the dub when I'm maximizing. The sounds of the gentleman, we're super silent. Super silent. Sometimes, can you feel the pressure does unwind? Sometimes, even through the day and through the night. Sometimes, you can make the pressure does unwind. Sometimes, even for your spirit and your mind. Sometimes, can you feel the pressure does unwind? Sometimes, even through the day and through the night. Sometimes, you can make a pressure does unwind. Sometimes, it's for your spirit and your mind. Enter in the dance, plug it in and we begin. Crowd up in the center, they watch with the rhythm. Watch the way we drop it in a mixed timing. Rise and amplifying when we come in with the swing. Just following the back and naturally harmonizing. Climb into position, we synchronize things. Live from out the dub when I'm maximizing. The sounds of the gentleman, we're super silent. Super silent. Super silent.
time. Can you feel the pressure does unwind sometimes? Sometimes.
fallen hopes, faded dreams. Somebody just shut the door.
Shut the door in the face.
In the golden city.
A lot of loose ends, a lot of people that I wish I knew then. Friends beckon every second you spend. Went in the pen, every letter you send. I got a lot of love, a lot of loose ends, a lot of people that I wish I knew then. Friends beckon every second you spend. Went in the pen, every letter you send.
I've been listening to dreamy days. I'm in disarray. I realize it's everybody else is still astray. I feel ashamed. I know there ain't no saving away. They went astray. I went Australia. So what I'm supposed to say to them? When all this love's out of range, everything around me changed. I'm supposed to say the same. Turned down these free drinks I couldn't even name. And that, like all this money, isn't fucking up my brain. I've been going insane. Shell full of family remains. Broken heart is seeking none of them again. I pull the glass, stick my head out in the rain. Try and find another person I can blame. Sat up on this plane, and yo, I'm praying up we don't crash. Cause every night I shiver at the sight when we go back. Cause every night could be my last, and yeah, I know that. So I crack a smile for it goes black. Trust.
Enough when the going is tough. I wait till it falls on the fifth side. Without the country, so love. My take is I wish that.
I got a lot of love, a lot of loose ends, a lot of people that I wish I knew then. Friends beckon every second you spend, when wet in the pen, every letter you send. I got a lot of love, a lot of loose ends, a lot of people that I wish I knew then. Friends beckon every second you spend, when wet in the pen, every letter you sus. I wish you'd been there when my dad had died. I wish you'd been there when my mother cried. I wish you'd been there in the dragon night to see my side, look me in my eyes when I was paralyzed, and tell me everything's alright and push it to the side. It's just a sacrifice. At times I told a bag of lies, but not a pack of lies. But yours, told a couple ones, of course it was true. You only knew me from the dramatized. I feel an agonizing risk, cause in a thousand island, this is where I really wanna be when we were cracking wise. Cause it was black and white, literally black and white. White from my mother and my father was the blackest skies. I can see it's true. I see my mother rapping you. Shit, I think my dad'd take it too. Yeah, I just wish he knew.
Enough when the calling is tough. I wait till it falls on their face. Can't say without the panties of love. My take is I wish there was a better way.
I got a lot of love, a lot of loose ends, a lot of people that I wish I knew then. Friends beckon every second you spend, when wet in the pen, every letter you send. I got a lot of love, a lot of loose ends, a lot of people that I wish I knew then. Friends beckon every second you spend, when wet in the pen, every letter you send. Imagine all the friends you see most, each one you're pegging away, dependent on you putting pen to the page. And so you break it down, checking they're paid. Another day you're heartbreaking, you were sent to the stage, you feel that same rage. Watch the crowd, watch the stage, thinking shit. Rather in the crowd with your mates drinking, misbehaviors, catch another dame winking. You feel ashamed, guzzle Jaegers, your brain's sinking. You think it's deep, don't think it's depression. A misspent adolescence, but all this time, times of the essence. You would never learn from your lessons, you're stuck in that same quintessence, heartbreak, one in the same. Days change, but you're stuck in the game. It's like she's telling you you're young enough to be your uni. Somehow the one who sees through me. Calling you
Es hora de volar. Sueños lejanos, nada sé lo que parece. Abre tus alas, es hora de volar. Do, 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 do. Paraíso, los ángeles parecen noches de luna, melodía. Encantada con las estrellas, no puede quedarse, nada se lleva la pena. Llega lejos, me pregunto por qué, me pregunto por qué.
Thank you. get behind the sun and cast my weight. All I need's peace this mind. I can celebrate. All in all, there's something to give.
All in all, there's something to give.
All in all, there's something to do.
All in all, there's something to do.
All in all, there's something to live with you. With you. All I need is a sign to get behind the sun and cast its
weight.
All I need is a place to find, and there I'll celebrate. All in all, there's something to give.
All in all, there's something to give.
All in all, there's something to do.
All in all, there's something to do.
All in all, there's something to live with you.
With you.
Yeah.
If I call you sugar, if you call me honey, does this mean you got a hand in my fate? If you take my money, if I take your liberty, does it mean it's all down to loving me? If you open doors to me, I'll have the chance to respond. I'll treat you like a man. Oh, baby. Oh, baby. Sunshine better on the other side. Sunshine better when you make it shine. Sunshine better.
side, other side of the hill, sunshine and meadow. If I call you lover, and if you call me daddy, does it mean that we're in love? If you give me all you hate, open up the garden gate, does that mean that we're in love? Tell me, Shirley, call me, honey. Come on, darling, why don't you take all my money? We could run away naked through the flames of desire. But sometimes better on the other side. Sometimes better on the other side. Sometimes better on the other side. Sometimes better every time you make it smile. Yours appears. Sometime better on the other side, on the other side of the stream. Let you run as a man, let you run at night. Sometime better on the other side of things. Come on, darling, let's jump in the night. Sometime better on the
sometimes better on the other side.